back in the pocket now. And here comes the throw. Open, complete, oh, incredible catch. Throwing right, and it is easily into the end zone. No one there to even touch it. Back in the pocket once again. Downfield, it is complete. Beautifully thrown for the touchdown.
What a grab for the touchdown.
What a beautiful pass.
What a catch.
Now he looks to the end zone, and it's picked off by the Wildcats.
This time he gets a block, heads up the sideline, hurdles a man, and gets past the 50-yard line.
Welcome to the final game of the 2016 Prairie Football Conference regular season. ICU Video Productions is proud to bring you this afternoon's regular season finale between the Regina Thunder and the Edmonton Wildcats. Good afternoon, friends. I'm Kevin Donnan, and I'll be your host for today's contest. And with ICU Video, we don't webcast, we procast. The Regina Thunder come into this game with a ton of confidence after knocking off the league-leading Calgary Colts last week at home in the biggest upset of the PFC season. And they're looking to keep that momentum going today as they get ready to meet Calgary or Saskatoon in the first round of the playoffs next week. And that will, of course, depend on the outcome of the Hilltops Rifles game in Winnipeg today. The Wildcats here on Wildcat Alumni Day, on the other hand, they come into their final game looking to avoid a winless season, and today's game is certainly an audition for many returning players looking to change the fortunes of this club in 2017. One team is preparing for the postseason and the other is getting ready for next year, but both clubs want to finish 2016 on a winning note. Thank you for joining us as we bring you the 2016 PFC regular season finale. My colleagues Rob Harrod and Dave Rozak are upstairs in the media center here at Clark Park in beautiful downtown Edmonton as they will call today's game. And gentlemen, don't tell Wildcats head coach Darcy Park that he's simply playing out the string today.
You know Darcy Park as well as I do, Kevin Donnan. I'll tell you what, he is in here to play football and
he's
to
ready.
Get a win for his football team.
You bet.
All right, and nobody would know better than Rob Harrod as coach of the Millwoods Christian football team. Rob, what it's like to be a coach of a team that is going into the last game of the season winless. And it's been a tough season for Darcy Park and his coaching staff.
It has been a tough year, and you know Darcy's competitive, and I think his players are going to be exactly the same way. There's going to be different emotions kind of running through the players today. You know, for the graduating players, it may be their last opportunity to don helmet and pads and play the game, and for the young guys, they're obviously going to come out with passion. They want to earn a spot. They want to prove to the coaching staff that they can do it, and they can be the guy they look to next year.
And you know, the really tough thing for Darcy Park is that he started the season with 17 players on the injured list. He now has 19 players on the injured list. That gives you a pretty good idea of what kind of a season it's been for the Edmonton Wildcats.
It's tough to work with that as a head coach, but as a head coach, you know that's part of football.
And their number one quarterback is among the injured, Colton Hippey. And we are about to get this football game underway, so let's get down to field level. And the opening kickoff of this game between the Edmonton Huskies, I'll make that the Edmonton Wildcats, I think I'm still here from last night, and the Regina Thunder. The Regina Thunder will be doing the honors and kicking off to the Huskies, who will be defending the zone to our right in the blue and white, predominantly blue, and the Regina Thunder in the predominantly white uniforms. Counting down a couple of seconds, and we are set to get this football game underway. Final game of the regular season in the Prairie Football Conference for both these teams. The Wildcats looking to next year. The Regina Thunder looking to get some momentum, the all-important momentum, going into the playoffs. And there's the kickoff. It's a short end-over-end kick. Bounces down at about the 20. Picked up there and taken upfield to the 30, still going, and finally taken down was Isaiah Brown. Brown with a run back of close to 10 yards on the play, and the Edmonton Wildcats will take the football over at the 31-yard line. And let's welcome into the football game his first start of the regular season, Austin Erickson, in there replacing an injured Colton Hippey, who is out with a dislocated ankle. And not only that, but their number three quarterback and defensive back, Justin Swedish, is also out. He is gone with a shoulder injury. Erickson in the pocket, pass is complete at about the 35-yard line, and a good way to start the football game for the youngster.
You know, great way for a coach to get the young guy just a little bit comfortable in the pocket, you know, get the ball out on time, and we'll see how much he does that, you know, to eliminate some of those pressure issues that teams can face. They're going to get that ball out in a hurry so he doesn't take any big shots early and shake his confidence. But I think we'll see a lot from him today.
A gain of 5. It'll be 2nd and 5. They mark the ball down at the 36-yard line. Erickson out of the... shotgun has the lone setback, now back in the pocket, takes off with the football, and he was being pressured and managed to forge ahead for a couple of yards, or maybe a yard gain on the play.
Well, you see there, they actually went with a cover zero, and if a young quarterback can recognize that early, he's going to have a chance to take a shot downfield. The safety vacated the middle. There was nobody there. So, again, if he sees that again, hopefully he can take advantage of that.
All right, Matt Zeroni does the kicking for the Edmonton Wildcats, and he is standing back at about his 20-yard line, a 2-and-out for the Wildcats. If you've just joined us, this is Prairie Football Conference action coming to you from Clark Park in Edmonton. Zeroni gets an end over end. It'll get a good bounce, though, forward to about the 43-yard line and taken all the way up to the 48. A run back of about 5 yards on the play, and the Regina Thunder are going to have good field position to get their game started.
Yeah, they are. They're sitting in a good position right now. And again, good job by the Wildcats to allow the quarterback to get out there. You know, he completed a pass. He did take off and scramble, which again, a lot of players like that hit once just to get into the game. So we'll see what Regina can do on their first series.
Jacob Swan with that run back for about 5 yards from Sturgeon Heights High School in Winnipeg. Out of the shotgun, there's the pitch to the right side, down to the midfield stripe to the 50, still going with it, grabbed by the shoulder and taken down at about the 35-yard line as number 31, Victor St. Pierre, one of the leading rushers in the Prairie Football Conference. He had a heck of a game last week in that win over Calgary.
Well, you can see why on that first toss play, he made one quick step to the inside and hit the hole hard and had a lot of space. He's going to be tough to track down.
And for the first down, the ball is on the 35-yard line, and right off the top, the Regina Thunder threatening in Edmonton Wildcats territory with 12:29 to go in the first quarter. There's the snap and the handoff once again to St. Pierre, and St. Pierre is stopped after a gain of about 4 yards on the play. So this time he tries the left side. And,
yeah, not so much success. Good flow by the Wildcats. And again, he's going to be a back that they're going to try to create opportunity one-on-one in open space. He's going to be a tough guy to bring down. You could see on that first play the quick step, the explosives he had. So, you know, a D lineman or a linebacker in open space probably is going to win that a lot. So they're going to have to do it as a unit on defense to slow him down today.
For a team that is primarily a passing team, he has done exceptionally well on the ground this year. There's the pass, speaking thereof, and incomplete, intended for St. Pierre along the sidelines. Just a little bit too high. He couldn't quite bring it down.
Yeah, it was a little. I think the release was a little high on the quarterback's part. Just sailed over the head. And again, when you're throwing to a running back, sometimes the running backs don't catch the ball quite as well as receivers. And in that case, it was just a little bit high for him. But I'm sure we'll see lots of him today. And great little strategy, again, using your running back out of the backfield, also throwing to him. You know, and you talked about a team that likes to throw the ball. You know, that's a great compliment to a running back who likes to get his touches, because if you got to worry about the passing game, you're not going to worry about as much in the run game.
Sawyer Buettner is not dressed for this football game. He was among the top quarterbacks in the Prairie Football Conference heading into this game. He's got a little bit of a nick, so they left him at home. And here is the field goal attempt from about the 32-yard line, and it is good.
At 37-yard James Reed field goal.
And the Regina Thunder with a field goal, and they take a 3-0 lead over the Edmonton Wildcats. And that in itself would have to be a pretty good sign for the Wildcats. They were able to stop the Regina Thunder.
Yeah, and you know what? They rallied on defense to get a stop on first down and then an incomplete pass, and that's going to happen. And so you know what? They're going to be happy with that. They're going to have to get the offense moving. As we've talked about in weeks past, that offense, good first down production on the last series, and they need to convert that second down to keep the drive going, gain a little bit of momentum for this young quarterback.
So a 37-yard field goal, and the Regina Thunder lead this one by a score of 3-0, 11:25 to go here in this first quarter. Official signal time in. Austin Erickson, twin setbacks. And now Bray Josu will take the handoff, and he has stopped right at the line of scrimmage. Went nowhere quickly, and in there to make the tackle, plugging that hole very fast, was number 93, Carson Bell, out of Assiniboia, Saskatchewan.
Yeah, they came out in a 40 defense, so 4D linemen and three linebackers, which had to shift because of the motion of the offense, but the defensive line did a great job of gap cancellation, and he was right there to make the tackle in the hole.
So it's a loss of about a yard. Wildcats, second and 11. Again, back in the pocket, looking downfield. He has a man open and couldn't quite get it to him. Great route there taken by number eight, Brandon Olson. And Olson was in behind the defender, just couldn't reach the football.
Yeah, you know, we talked about in the first series how he saw the cover zero. It was the same look, a little bit of a different defense. What we saw there was the free safety came up, and instead of sending everybody, which they did in the first, to give one-on-one coverage all the way across the field, they actually dropped another linebacker, kind of as a robber in the middle. Uh-huh. But that's exactly what you want to see a young quarterback do, is send it deep when there's no one there to protect against that.
All right, Zeroni with the end over end down to about the 45-yard line, and nailed quickly after a run back of only 3 yards or so. The football taken there by number 83, Jaquin Swan.
Yeah, I think that was James Enns on the tackle. That was a great job. He got downfield in a hurry and then broke down his feet on special teams, and all your special teams coaches are going to teach you, don't overrun the ball, because a lot of guys will run past and it just takes one step. He broke down really well, stayed playable to the ball, and just fell off the block to make a nice tackle and limit the gain.
All right, they put the ball down at about the 49-yard line. It'll be first down for the Regina Thunder, and again with good field position. Motion goes to the right there, taken by number 22, Daniel Borge. Flanked on this side, Quads on the far side, and now looking downfield, here is the pass. It is picked off at about the 45-yard line. And in there to intercept that one was Jaden Dulkey out of Leduc Composite High School. And for him, that's his second interception of the season.
You know, good job by the corner of sitting there on the sideline, eyes to the inside. He saw that ball come off. I think he was trying to hit his running back coming across the field. Did a good job just falling off his man and picking that off.
So they go to the short side of that field with Quads on the far side. And I tell you what, the receiver was surrounded by about three or four blue shirts.
Yeah, there was a number of guys there, and if he could have kept his feet, he probably could have got about 15 yards on a return or more. So great job, another great play by the defense.
Well, the Wildcats take it over on their own 40. There's the play action and the pass. It is it's complete, and there is also an interference call on the play, but out there to make that catch was number 82, Dalton Latosky. And I'll tell you what, Latosky did a great job of getting in front of that defender.
Yeah, he did. He had to come back, adjust to the ball.
That's always something that you need to worry about when the ball is up that high and kind of floating in towards you, but he was able to come back to it.
Regina, number 2. That penalty is declined. Result of the play. First down.
All right, clearance call is waved off, as you might expect, and the Wildcats move into Thunder territory at about the 42-yard line. Austin Erickson, starting at quarterback for the first time this season, looks downfield, throws a one up in behind the defender was number 8, again, Brandon Olson, and he has been matched up a couple of times against number 5 for the Regina Thunder, Medidim Menegbo. And he's beaten him twice now, but couldn't quite get the ball to him.
Yeah, you know what? And it's a good job of letting Regina's defense know that you are not afraid to go deep. And again, you can see on the replay there is no deep coverage. So if they can start making plays downfield, you know what? They're going to soften the defense. They're going to take one more guy out of the box. And I'm sure Regina's thinking, well, if we can crowd the box and force them to throw the ball, we'll have success. But at this point, you know what? They have had some success throwing the ball downfield. Now those receivers are going to have to win the one-on-one matchups and make plays.
You know, we talk about Brandon Olson. Interestingly enough, with the Wildcats losing their number 1 and number 3 quarterbacks, that leaves the backup task to one Brandon Olson, who was back in his day in high school, was a pretty fair quarterback.
Well, let's hope we don't have to see him there today.
For Jasper Place, actually. Back in the pocket now. Here's the little dump pass. It is complete, dropped, and the ball is loose, but I believe the Wildcats are going to come up with it. They may even have a first down. It's going to be very, very close, but taking that pass was number 7, Jordan Samuel, and Samuel dropped it, but fortunately for the Wildcats, they were able to recover, and they're about a yard short of the first.
Well, I like the flow of the offense right now. They've gone downfield. Now the pass rush is going to come, and they run a little screen to get the ball or get the ball into the hands of your playmakers. So I like what Jeff's doing with the offense, mixing it up, and really it seems like he's one step ahead of the Regina defense right now.
All right, over center this time, Austin Erickson, a yard short. He plunges ahead and will easily make enough for the first down, about the 30-yard line or so. So the Wildcats offense on the move, and it's good to see.
Yeah, it is. It's good to see early on. Again, you're going to gain confidence for your young quarterback. Again, it's a good situation for him to step into, though. It's not at the end of the game when they're down a few players in the offense. You know what? He's playing with the starting unit from the offensive line, minus some of the injuries, obviously, they've had this year. But he's playing with those starters that are slated in there, and it's going to give him the confidence to continue to move the ball here.
They mark it down at the 31-yard line, first and 10. Edmonton Wildcats, 8:08 to go in this first quarter, trailing by 3. Erickson out of the shotgun, sends everybody down and puts the ball up. It's going to be picked off at about the 5-yard line, and stepping in front of the receiver was number 2, Taylor Mayer, out of Regina. And it's going to be a turnover on the 1-yard line. And that ball just floated up there, and it was ready for the picking.
Yeah, we have seen a couple of those. You know, one, the receiver came back to the ball. He was able to. Here you can see their DB actually made the adjustment first. You know, the Regina is going to be pinned deep here. It's a good opportunity for the defense to, you know what, hold on to some of that momentum that the Wildcats have gained.
That pass was intended for Dalton Latosky out of Wetaskiwin, from the Wetaskiwin Sabres. And so it's first down for the Regina Thunder. Ball on their own 1-yard line. In there at quarterback is number 13, Brock Sitch, replacing Buettner. And he hands it off to Victor St. Pierre, who picks up a gain of close to 3 yards on the play. They'll mark it at around the 4-yard line. So the Edmonton Wildcats defensive line coming up big on that one.
Yeah, they've got a good opportunity here on second and about 7 or so to get a stop. And you know, then put Regina in a position where they're going to have to make a decision where they give a safety and the ball up, or they try to punt it away. We'll see if the defense can come up with a good play. So far, things are looking good for the Wildcats.
Well, Brock Sitch has seen some action this season with the Thunder before the injury to Sawyer Buettner. And so he's no stranger to the PFC. And he dumps one into the middle, wide open, taken there by number 80, Christopher Calcutt. And Calcutt is piled up at about the 20-yard line, a gain of close to, we'll call it 14 yards or so, and first down for the Regina Thunder. They are out of the danger zone.
Yeah, a nice little play design, bringing a receiver from the short side of the field across the formation. When you see a defense stepping into a zone, if you don't pass those guys off well and the linebackers don't see him coming, created a lot of space after the catch for him to get the first down and get out of the shadows of their goalposts.
All right, first down for the Thunder. Ball on the 20-yard line. Brock Sitch at quarterback, takes the high snap, hands it off to St. Pierre, and St. Pierre is stopped at the line of scrimmage. And there'll be no gain, but there is a flag on the far side of the field.
Yeah, interesting to see what the Regina Thunder are doing. Sometimes they have that fifth receiver, and sometimes they bring kind of a fullback, a little bit of a receiver into the mix, and they use him as a kind of a tight end type of formation. You could see at the beginning, he was there lined up in a strong formation.
So we're awaiting the call from the officials, likely along the line. It's going to go against
offside.
The Edmonton Wildcats.
Edmonton, number 44. 5-yard penalty remains first down. There's also a blood timeout on the field.
All right, there is a timeout. The call was offside against the Wildcats, and with 6:08 to go in this first quarter, it's been moving along pretty quickly, this game.
Yes, it has. A couple drives. You mean Regina had a little bit of a drive going that led to a field goal. The Wildcats did a good job when they got the ball back and moved the ball down the field. So it's ticking away. And again, we're going to have to see if the Cats can eliminate some of those penalties to put them in, which put Regina's offense into a good favorable position here at first and 5.
All right. Ball on the 25-yard line. Twin setbacks this time. And the handoff, second man through. A little misdirection play to St. Pierre, and St. Pierre is going to go all the way, 20, 10, for the touchdown. Nobody can catch him. And Victor St. Pierre with the first touchdown of the football game, and that little misdirection in the backfield was what made the difference.
Yeah, and when you have a back like that, all it takes is a little bit of a seam, which we saw created there, and off to the races he went. And when you get into open field, it's a difficult type of running back to bring down, and he made the most of that one and went the whole distance there.
That's the first time that we've seen the Regina Thunder use that twin setback, and as I said, with that misdirection, the fake handoff, and then the handoff to St. Pierre.
Yeah, they are using that secondary back, and I don't know what they're going to call it. You know, sometimes he's a slot back, sometimes he's a fullback or tight end, but they've used him well so far, obviously, and created space for the running back.
All right, here's the point after. It is good. And with 5:45 to go in this first quarter, the Regina Thunder come out with a 10-0 lead over the Edmonton Wildcats.
Guys, Kevin down here on the Wildcats sideline, you talked off the top of the broadcast about the injury list, and one of the Wildcat players that I know head coach Darcy Park was very pleased to see on the sideline is regular starter at quarterback Colton Hippie, who suffered a devastating injury, a dislocated ankle and a broken tibia that required surgery. So we certainly want to wish him the best as he recovers from this injury and gets ready for 2017. Guys?
No question about that. Hippie is a team player. There's no doubt about it. And he's a welcome addition out there on the bench for the Edmonton Wildcats. And so the kickoff from the 45-yard line. Good end-over-end kick. It'll come down to about the 15-yard line. Up to the 30 and still going with it to about the 32-yard line, taken there by Isaiah Brown once again, and the Bev Facey grad picks up a run back of close to 14 yards on the play.
That was a nice high kick, good hang time. That allowed the cover team for Regina to get downfield and just corral the returner there and limit the game.
The Regina Thunder are missing their number one kicker and punter Tyson Hobrick, who is out with a little bit of a knock. They're resting him for the playoffs, as you might expect. And this is Erickson with the handoff to Bray Josu. Josu tries the hole and then reverses his field, but picks up about a yard or so on the play, not much more than that. That Regina Thunder defensive line is coming up tough.
Yeah, they are, but again, they're bringing that extra personnel into the box. So unless the Cats can take advantage of it and go over the top a few times without a free safety, they're gonna continue to bring another guy into the box. Now you're playing against one extra body in there, which can make a big difference.
They go with that 40 defense, and it seems to be working very well for them. This is Erickson back in the pocket, throws into the middle. It is picked off at the 40-yard line. And going all the way for the pick six is number 10, Marcus Hall, out of Campbell High School in Regina. And the Regina Thunder now just putting all kinds of pressure on Austin Erickson.
Yeah, you know what? He had time to get that ball out of the pocket. And you can see here in the replay, he's waiting on it. He had a guy in his face. And again, the ball just didn't come out really clean out of the backfield. And then obviously the more aggressive person on the receiving end of that, you mean the receiver was there, could have at least made it, try to make a play on the ball. DB being more aggressive had the opportunity, and then he was clear to the end zone.
We've seen in past games with Erickson in at quarterback that he tends to throw that ball quite high. It looks like he's back on his back foot when he's throwing.
Yeah, it can be on his back foot, especially when a guy's in his face in that situation. But a lot of times for a quarterback, if your ball release is a little bit higher, and he's a tall guy with long arms, if he releases that ball high, sometimes it can get away and float. Now we're talking about a cold ball. Mm-hmm. You know, it's probably hit the turf, and although the turf looks really green, it's probably still slippery in this type of temperature with just brushing the snow off. I noticed a few times there that the ball skipped off the turf when it has hit the turf. So you can see on that aggressive DB on that replay, and then he goes all the way to the end zone. So he's going to have to just get control of that intermediate pass, which was what he was trying to hit there, and then the receivers are going to have to help him out a little bit as well.
The turf is in surprisingly good condition, considering the fact that we had about, 4 or 5 inches of snow just a couple of days ago. The city had to come out there with the plows and clean it off, and they did a great job, and really the turf is in not that bad a shape.
It's not bad at all, and this turf here at the field here is actually really, really good. I've played on it. I've had my teams play on it, and for a winter field, this is in great shape.
All right, there's a short kick down to the 40-yard line, taken there and downed by number 81, Jacob Probe, or make that Luther Hakavanu. And so the Wildcats will take over the football at that point at about the 42-yard line.
Guys, another thing, sorry to jump in here, guys, but another thing that's affecting the football is that there is a very fine mist rolling in. You can barely feel it, but it could be affecting the football. There's definitely a little bit of a mist right now. Not exactly freezing rain, but there's definitely some precipitation lingering, guys.
Scotch mist?
Not the kind I'd prefer.
Back in the pocket, and now taking off with it is Austin Erickson. He's up to the 50 and taken down from behind at around the 51-yard line. He's going to be just short of the first down. And again, the pressure is on Erickson.
Yeah, it's going to be on him all day. He's going to have to work. He's going to have to settle in. You know, some of the throws we've seen earlier, although, you know, Sab's receivers make some plays for him, he's going to have to dial it in and just be a little bit more on target with his throws. But again, as he gets more comfortable, give him a chance to set his feet, and hopefully the O-line can give him the time to do that. We know he can throw the ball with accuracy.
He's had to take off with the ball a couple of times, but that's the first time he's had success with it in this football game, picking up about 9 yards on the play.
Yeah, and if you're O-line in pass protection, again, you want to create that pocket. And as soon as a seam is created in that pocket, he needs to make the decision quickly to either go or deliver the ball. If he's not making that decision quickly, he's going to have a tough time finding the space to run. In that case, you know what? The linebacker's got a really deep drop in their pass coverage, and that opened up the space. And so that's something a little different that the Regina has shown now, where they're dropping everybody out. They were bringing everybody at the beginning of the game, got a few balls downfield. Now they're dropping out. Make him throw accurate throws.
One issue that may face Austin Erickson is the fact that they are missing their number one fifth-year center, Jonathan Harkey, who's out for today's game, and as well fourth-year tackle Michael Budjak. So all kinds of injuries along that line.
Yeah, you know, it gets those young guys experience. And again, there's a learning curve that's going to happen. And unfortunately, the quarterback can sometimes pay the price for having a beat-up O-line.
All right, we have an injured Regina Thunder player down there. And they're picking him up, and he should be able to come off the field under his own steam. That is Ryland Gibb out of Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, Carlton High School up in Prince Albert. And he is being helped off the field, so looks like he might be favoring his right leg.
Wish him all the best. I've spent quite a bit of time up in Prince Albert. I have family up there, so I used to fish as a boy. So good. I know the place well.
They've got some pretty good fishing up there.
They definitely do.
Twin setbacks this time for Austin Erickson and the Edmonton Wildcats. There's the handoff up the middle to Jordan Samuel, and Samuel out of Bev Basie picks up enough for the first down, and they'll mark it at around the center field stripe. So Jordan Samuel in his final PFC game, seeing lots of action in this first quarter.
Yeah, and it's good. You know he's going to play with passion. You know he's going to want to get touches. And you talk about the last game of the year for this team. Nobody is going to want to come out of this game. Every player is going to want to stay out there, and they're not going to be happy if the coach is pulling them out.
Ball on the 54-yard line. First down for the Wildcats. Everybody heads downfield. And again, Austin Erickson being pressured from that defensive line, and coming up with the tackle was number 92 for the Regina Thunder, Ryan Warner out of Campbell High School.
Well, the O-line's just going to have to give him a little bit more time. As that play developed, they had a couple under routes coming in front of him. He was just waiting for him to clear, and there was no chance, no time for him to get that ball delivered.
So a loss of close to 10 yards. It'll be second and 20. Ball on the 45-yard line. Now rolling out, looking downfield. Erickson may have to take off with it again. Finally gets the ball away to an open man down at around the 50-yard line. There is a flag on the play. A pass complete to number 80, Brandon Rebnord. And do we have a holding or a roughing the passer?
I'm not sure. We'll have to keep an eye on the officials and see what they say. It could be either. It was kind of in that position where it could be either. But, man, what a job by a young quarterback to stand in there. Probably a throw your offensive coordinator would never recommend, to stop your feet, but he actually got a chance to stop his feet, reset, and deliver back across the grain, which can be dangerous at times. But, again, he wants to make plays. He's out there to make plays. He knows this is the last game of the year, and he wants to make the most of his opportunity.
He was about to get hit high, too, with a big arm, but he was able to get out of that. And when you see that coming down on top of your face, it's not fun.
Well, I was surprised that he actually got this ball. We'll see on the replay. He sets up. He has the time. But there's three guys and one D lineman getting pressure on
Holding.
Him. And almost seen.
Number 45. That penalty's declined. Result of the play is third down.
It is a holding call against the Wildcats. It'll be declined. So it'll be third down and about six.
So, yeah, that ball floating around with D lineman around you, it can be just tapped out of your hand so quickly and the ball's on the ground, and then it's anybody's opportunity. So
another injured Regina Thunder player being helped off the field. That is number 47, Paul Toth, out of Sault Coates, Saskatchewan.
You know, that was a great play because he gained 15 yards on it, although he's still going to have to punt it away here on third down. That 15 yards makes a pretty big difference in field position, and we'll see if the defense is ready to come up with a stop here and maybe give their offense an opportunity to get the ball into the end zone.
The Thunder awaiting this punt at about the 15, 16 yard line. They utilize two receivers on this, and Matt Zeroni getting ready to kick it away with 2:44 to go in this first quarter. Wildcats trail by 10. Or make that 17, and Zeroni off the side of his foot, it'll go out of bounds at about the 43-yard line, and that's not what you want to see trailing by 17 points in the first quarter.
Well, it's shanked punts like that, as a coach you think, gosh, should I have gone for it on third down? They gained about 8 yards. You might as well have given yourself a chance, unfortunately for him, although we haven't seen a lot of that this year. Unfortunately, it was not a great kick, and that's not gonna help the field position battle here.
Well, if there is a bit of a mist around, it could affect the football as well, makes the football a little wet.
Yeah, it could be that frozen mist that I had to scrape off my car this morning.
All right, Brock Sitch at quarterback for the Regina Thunder. There's the handoff to St. Pierre once again. He's got room, gets around a couple more tacklers, and is finally taken down at about the 30-yard line, and that will be a big gain of close to 30, 40 yards.
Well, they're having a really tough time tackling him. I mean, on the last touchdown, he broke two tackles. On this one, you can see he's not even touched. He is so quick around, and the defense for the Wildcats are going to have to play faster, and they're going to have to track him down a lot sooner.
Finally taken down by number 21, Jaden Dulkey, at the 31-yard line. And so once again, the Regina Thunder, late here in the first quarter, threatening in Wildcat territory. Quads to this side of the field for the Thunder, and they blow it down. Time count violation coming up against the Thunder. We'll wait for the official from the official.
Time count violation, Regina, number 12, 5-yard penalty. Remains first down. Please reset the clock to 1 minute, 28 seconds. 1 minute, 28 seconds.
So that'll move the ball back to the 36-yard line. Sitch coming into this game 9-for-11 in the passing department with a couple of TDs and 144 yards total. He'll have a chance to up that total big time in this game.
28 seconds.
Do we have it on the clock, sir?
So again, they have four to this side. Motion goes to the right. Looking back, downfield, into the middle, complete. Taken there by number 9, Hakeem Okeya, out of Pilot Butte, Saskatchewan, and he'll pick up a gain of about maybe 3 yards. It'll be second and still a long ways to go, 12 yards to be exact.
Once and on first and long, and now again on second and long. We've seen a lot of it this year from the Wildcats. They're going to be sitting in a zone defense, using the knowledge and the game awareness of their secondary to really rally to those tackles underneath.
Okeya flanked out to the left side. They've got quads over there. And back in the pocket, and again looking deep into the end zone. It's a pick ball and knocked down. Good defensive play by Jaden Dahlke once again as he went high to knock that one away from the intended receiver, number 80 for the Saskatchewan, for the Regina Thunder, Christopher Kalka.
Yeah, they did, but they both did a good job of actually being aggressive to the ball. We'll have a good chance to see it on the replay here. They both go up. It seems like they both get their hands on the ball almost simultaneously, both trying to rip at it. Great job of the DB to get it out of his hands.
Also on that coverage for the Wildcats was number 22, Isaiah Brown. And a 41-yard field goal attempt for the Regina Thunder. Ball is down, it's out, it's up, and it is short and wide of the goalpost. And here's a chance for the Wildcats to take it out. They get it out to about the 9-yard line, so that's where the Wildcats will take over the football, as it did not go into the end zone, so they won't be able to take it out to the 20, as they normally would. Well, they do.
It looks like it is, yeah. It looks like it just got into the end zone there, and I think he got it out.
It's those darn yellow lines from the soccer team.
A little surprised we didn't see a little tripping call there. One of the coverage guys actually got juked and he threw his leg out there on the returner. We could have maybe seen that been thrown.
So it'll be first down for the Wildcats on their own 20-yard line. Rolling to his right is Erickson. Erickson now gets a good strong pass away. It is picked off at the 50-yard line. And again, the defender stepping in front of the intended receiver. And that was Taylor Mayer with his second pick of the afternoon.
Well, he's definitely not gun shy back there. He's gonna have to deliver that ball a little bit earlier, so it gives his receiver a chance to run through the route. It just kind of floated up there, and again, DB made a good job of really positioning his body in front of the receiver, and then he went up and made a great catch.
And so the Thunder will take the ball over in Wildcat territory. They mark it at about the 51-yard line. Brock Sitch sends three players downfield on this side and hands it off up the middle, taken by number 34, Ethan Houts. And Houts out of Luther College in Regina. 52 carries going into this football game, gets his first of the game.
Yeah, they've got another back in there to get some reps. It'll be interesting to see how they rotate their personnel. Again, the coaches want to use this game to tune up for next week. Regina's going to be have a big task at hand next week, and so they're really going to want to make sure they're ready to go and have all their bodies, one, healthy, but two, not rest them too long. Let them continue to build on what they've learned all year.
So that is the end of the first quarter of football, with the Edmonton Wildcats trailing the Regina Thunder by a score of 17-0. It looked like the Wildcat defense was going to come up pretty big in the early going of this first quarter, but the Regina Thunder, just such a strong football team.
Well, you've seen some big plays, obviously, and Regina has made most of them in this football game, although it doesn't seem like it's out of hand or anything. It seems like a fairly close game. The score is showing differently right now.
And at this time, the Edmonton Wildcats Football Club would like to thank the following supporters: WestJet, JC Boiler Service, Rough Rider International, On the Rocks, McElhaney, TD Insurance, Flamin Fitness, Dental Choice, the Edmonton Eskimos Football Club, and of course the folks at Commonwealth Stadium as well. A great list of sponsors, and of course without sponsorship, the Edmonton Wildcats would not be nearly as successful as they have been.
Yeah, sponsors are also always important, and again, the Cats are trying to build something that's going to, you know, have a culture of success that Darcy's trying to create within his team. And again, a season like this is always tough to work through, but again, it's a step in a process, and the organization and the people around the organization understand there's a process involved here of building a quality football team, setting character, all those types of things that you want to do.
You know, we've mentioned that this is Alumni Day, and there are a great number of alumni from the Edmonton Wildcats in attendance at this football game. It's Alumni Day because there are a number of graduates who are being or will become alumni in about, say, a couple of hours' time or so. Among them, Michael Budjack from Bev Facey High School, Aaron Coburn, Travis Louv, Jeremy Fanyan, Jonathan Harkey, Cameron Mashmeyer, and as well Jordan Samoil, who is out there from Bev Facey. So we wish all those guys the best of luck in whatever they choose to go on to from football.
Yeah, well, and hopefully they stay involved in the game, in the development of any game, you know, from the younger ages. You hope the players, once they do finish, and for these guys it's coming up soon, they stay involved either in a coaching capacity or mentoring younger players.
Ball on the 49-yard line. It'll be second and about eight. The Wildcats showing blitz. Now they back off, and down in the pocket, there is the pass from Sitch. It is complete, wide open at about the 40-yard line, and looks like it was taken there by number 34, Ethan Houts.
Good job of the quarterback recognizing to hit the guy underneath because of the drops by the linebackers. And you can see there's a flag on the play as well.
The official signaling against the Edmonton Wildcats.
That's going to add to the end of the run here. I think it may have been a face mask.
And it's 15 yards.
Edmonton, number four. 15 yards from the end of the play. First down.
So that will move the football deep into Wildcats territory at the 20-yard line. Tough break for the Wildcats. Penalties early part of the season really hurt them. They've been pretty good the last couple of games, but that kind of 15-yarder deep in their own territory has got to hurt. Motion goes to the right. That's Houts moving out there, back in the pocket now, looking into the middle. The pass is complete, and again, nobody there to cover the receiver, Hakeem Okaya, and Okaya will go ahead over the 5-yard line, and I think he'll be stopped at around the 3 or 4 yard line. But again, that pass up the middle, there's just no one there to cover. It looks like the defensive backfield is just moving back and covering deep.
Well, the linebackers are getting their drops, and again, they're designed to drop and keep everything underneath. Unfortunately, when you do that, you've got to rally and make a tackle at 5 yards or at 7 yards to force second down. In this case, they're just not making those tackles, and athletically, Regina's get taken advantage of that.
All right, ball on the three, first and goal. Pass is knocked down in the end zone, intended again for Okaya, and he was being well covered by Jaden Dalkey.
Yeah, again, they're dropping into a zone, and there's a lot of bodies flying around short. Again, with a shorter end zone, you're going to have the opportunity to kind of jump things, because you know you can't get beat over the top, and so that's you see a couple guys around and in through the hands of the receiver.
13:38 to go in the first half. Second and goal for the Regina Thunder. There's the handoff to Houts. Houts is hit once in the backfield and then is taken down shy of the line of scrimmage. There'll be a loss of about a yard or two on the play. Great defensive stand here for the Edmonton Wildcats. Now the only question is, do they go for it or do they try the field goal?
Well, they've got a flag to sort out. Both side judges look like they threw the flag, so it's likely going to be an offside or a procedure. It looks like it's going against Regina, so that's good for the Wildcats.
Offensive offside against the Regina Thunder. That'll move the ball back or decline it.
Offside, Regina number 80. That penalty is declined, third down.
It is declined, and so again, that choice. Do you go for it or do you try the field goal?
Well, it looks like they're willing to take that risk, and they're going to take their third shot at the end zone here and see if they can get seven instead of three.
Huge play coming up for the Edmonton Wildcats. Ethan Houts, the lone setback. The quarterback is Brock Sitch in for Sawyer Buettner, and Sitch in the pocket fires. Quick opener and complete, and a touchdown for the Regina Thunder, taken by number 80, Christopher Calcutt.
Well, the one thing you usually see on something inside the 20, inside the 10 for sure, is you're going to see zone or man coverage by a defense, and that's exactly what they get. And when you can predict what the defense is, then you can make the best decision for your offense. And they obviously felt like they had a matchup that they could win, and they were willing to take that risk when they got down to the goal line, knowing they're likely going to get man coverage, which they did.
Point after to be attempted by James Reed from Balgonie, Saskatchewan. Reed is the backup kicker, and he does a good job putting it through the uprights. And so with 13:12 to go in the first half, it's a 24-0 football game in favor of the Regina Thunder over the Edmonton Wildcats.
And you can see there, it's hard to see the guy coming in from the outside. It was likely just a little, three-step slant. Quarterback sets his feet, delivers the ball on time. Good job delivering the ball. And again, when you run a slant pattern, which is basically three steps, 45 degrees to the inside, you want to deliver that ball low and in front of the receiver so only he can get it. Very, very hard to defend if a really good route is run.
Great camera coverage from down at the field level as well on that replay. And so once again, Reed will be called upon to kick this one away. The Greenhall High School graduate gets a good end over end down to about the 15 yard line, taken there up to the 30, still going to the 35 and finally stopped at about the 40 yard line. So a good 30 yard run back, or 25 yard run back, for the Huskies, or for the Wildcats rather.
Yeah, that's a good way to start. I mean, you're out almost to the 40 yard line. That's going to give the offense a little bit of a shorter field to work with.
Isaiah Brown doing the honors once again for the Wildcats, one of the top kick returners in the Prairie Football Conference. He's had a pretty good season. Lone setback is Samoil. Samoil takes the handoff and plows ahead for a gain of close to, we'll call it 5 yards or so on the play.
That's good first down production. That's what you want to see, and that gives yourself the option to go to the pass the run here on second down. It doesn't limit you, and it keeps the defense kind of just a little bit more off balance.
They continue to go, the Regina Thunder continue to go with that 40 defense. And the Wildcats looking to exploit that. He has an open man in the middle, and it is just thrown short, intended for Brandon Samoil, or Jordan Samoil rather. And he had out there number 80, Brandon Rebnord, wide open in the middle of that in the middle of the field.
Yeah, unfortunately that was delivered a little bit low. We didn't have a chance, but yeah, another guy wide open, you know, trying to make a play. Good job by the offensive line actually to create time. Although we had a 40 front, as you which you mentioned, they brought that extra guy down, still in a cover zero, and they brought him off the edge. And then we had one of the inside linemen. He actually kicked out all the way to the edge to buy him the extra time to deliver it. Unfortunately, he just didn't deliver it a little high enough.
All right, so once again, the Wildcats will be forced to kick this one away. Matt Zeroni with the fake, the direct snap. They take it up over the 45-yard line. They needed to get to the 48, 49-yard line, so they are well short on that direct snap on the fake punt. And you got a funny feeling the Regina Thunder were ready for that one.
Yeah, they just, I mean, not really well executed. We've seen a few different special teams plays over the course of the season, and some have been successful, probably more than not. That one, they tried to go up the middle. They obviously saw something on the Regina side that they hopefully were going to take advantage of, able to on that play.
They'll mark it at the 46-yard line. First down for the Regina Thunder in Wildcat territory on that turnover on downs. They've got four receivers in the backfield. Now everybody heads downfield. There it is. It's a long one, complete at the 20-yard line, in for the touchdown. His second of the football game. Number 80, Christopher Calcutt. And Christopher Calcutt, once again, having a phenomenal game. Earlier in the season, he set a couple of records in receiving and points and field goals and everything else. And again, coming up with a big one.
Yeah, you know what, he's doing a really good job of going and attacking the ball at a high point. And as a DB, he came over, he had a choice to make. Does he go up high? Does he make sure he secures the tackle? Unfortunately, he kind of challenged him up high, lost that battle, and into the end zone he went. And the route combination there by the outside two receivers, the outside receiver was running a little bit of post to try to drag the deep defender in. Inside guy ran a little bit of a wheel, got down the sideline, and a great ball was delivered on time, just in time, because a second later and that may have gone the other direction. But again, he delivered that on time to that wheel route. And again, something that most coaches use in their offense.
So Jimmy Reed with the point after, and with 11:27 to go in this first half, it's a 31-0 football game for the Regina Thunder. The Thunder have been kind of up and down throughout this entire season. They scored a huge win last week against the Calgary Colts, as Kevin Donnan mentioned in the preamble, and really are coming off a pretty big high after winning that game.
Not only does it help them in the standings, obviously, but the confidence that they're going to have. And you can see coming out here today, quarterback is throwing the ball with confidence. The O-line is moving people around, creating holes for the running backs. They're a dangerous team to catch in the playoffs, that's for sure.
All right, here is the kickoff by Reed down to about the 10-yard line. And a little dipsy-doodle pass, and it is going to be picked up by the by the Wildcats, Jordan Dalkey. They tried to flip it over to him, and he did have it, but he lost it and then pounced on it. So that'll bring the ball all the way down to about the 11-yard line.
You can see they're trying to run a reverse with their wingman. Unfortunately, the toss to him was a little bit high, hit him in the shoulders. Great awareness, though, to get on that ball and not just create more problems for their team.
So, and this is just the kind of thing you'd expect from Darcy Park. I mean, he wants his players to go out there and have some fun. They know the season has been a bit of a bust, so let's just go out on a high note and have some fun doing it.
Yeah, you know what? You got to try those things out. I mean, there's no reason to hide anything this year. You know what? They're going to have to regroup for next year and get things going again. So, hey, use what you have.
Luther Hakuna-Vanu with the reception. And the McNally grad picks up about 8 yards on the play. It'll be second and close to two. Oh, we'll call it three.
Looks like he got twisted down, so he's going to need some help coming off. Hopefully it's not long until he can re-enter this game.
Guys, Kevin down here on the sideline coming up at the half. Because it is Alumni Day here with the Edmonton Wildcats, I will be joined by Corbin Sharoon, of course, who knows virtually everything about every level of Canadian football. He was a Strathcona Lord. He played for St. FX. And, of course, the Wildcats, and also played with both Alberta teams in the CFL. Of course, the Eskimos and Stampeders. So we've got a great guest coming up at the half, guys.
A fellow Strathcona Lords graduate, I understand.
Absolutely. And I was going to say, not only is it alumni weekend for the Wildcats, it's alumni weekend for the local chapter of the Ottawa GGs alumni in our media center today. So to our two favorite GGs. It's the Edmonton chapter reunion, by the looks of things, or maybe even homecoming.
Yeah, that's exciting. Well, the game out east wasn't so exciting for Ottawa fans. They got a beat down by Western, so not so good on that end. But I think we're still in the playoffs.
There you go. That's the main thing right now. The GG's doing well.
Kevin, you've done your research. That's good.
always ready. Always doing my homework, Rob.
That hurts. It was such a long time ago. All right, this is Austin Erickson. Out of the shotgun, the pass into the middle. It is picked off once again at the 25-yard line and taken by Taylor Mayer. And Mayer is tackled at about the 28-yard line. And it just keeps going from bad to worse for the Edmonton Wildcats. I don't think I can think of anything else to say.
Well, you know what? You talked about the first quarter going quickly. I don't know if this second quarter can go quick enough right now. Things are just not going their way. But you know what? Really, what is creating this for the Regina team is they are flying around the field. They're playing at a higher speed, another level that is just, you know, obviously part of the success had last week. They've carried that into this week, and they are flying around the field. And they're excited to be out here playing football.
Brock Sitch at quarterback behind that huge offensive line. The direct snap and a carry for close to about 2 or 3 yards on the play. And obviously the Regina Thunder are going to get out there and try a few different things as well.
Yeah, again, they want to get toned up for playoffs, right? They want to be ready to go. You know, they know they're going to have to use their depth at some point in time. Guys get banged up, guys get tired. You know, they want to get all those reps for all their personnel that are going to be playing them and try to carry them through a playoff.
You take a look at that offensive line of the Regina Thunder. It is just huge. They are towering over a couple of those defensive linemen from the Wildcats. Back in the pocket, Sitch now will take off with it. He is tripped up from behind on a nice tackle there by number 44, Kieran Bell out of McNally High School.
Well, a team that does what Regina is doing right now has to have confidence in their O-line, as you mentioned. There are some big boys up there. They're usually sending almost every time 6 guys out into routes. And when you can send 6 guys out, that tells me you do have confidence that your O-line are going to hold down the fort and give your quarterback time to deliver the ball.
All right, so it's going to be second or third down, rather, and 5 and a field goal attempt. This one will come from about the 25-yard line. James Reed on the attempt. Ball is out, down, up, and it is through the uprights. And with 9:06 to go here in the second quarter, it's a 34-0 football game in favor of the Regina Thunder.
Yeah, the Cats are going to continue to just look for that spark, to just get a little bit of momentum. gain some confidence, build on, you know, a season that's been a tough season. You know, there's no doubt when you go winless, I mean, that can be challenging on players, on coaches, but it also builds character. And, you know, I know a lot of coaches, well, we don't want to stop building character. And I'm sure Darcy would say the same thing, and we want to, you know, use that character to build some wins. So they're definitely going to want to build some of that today and set things up for next year.
So they put the ball down at the 35-yard line. Erickson in the shotgun, hand off to Samuel, and Samuel plows ahead for a usual gain of about 3 or 4 yards on the play. Want to just mention, too, that we're going to have Kevin Donnan will not be the only guy being busy down there at field level at halftime. Just want to mention that the Edmonton Raiders will be playing a scrimmage at halftime. They're being guest coached by the Wildcat alumni from the 2016, Mike Wojcicki and Tyler Budinski.
Oh, that'll be great to see the young guys out on the field.
Be a big thrill for them to be able to play a little football game, even though it is an exhibition game. On the turf here at Clark Park. The pass, it is incomplete. Intended into the middle there for number 82, Dalton Latosky. And Latosky couldn't hold on to it. And so again, two and out for the Wildcats.
You know, in the cast, the players just aren't making the plays they need to make. You know, this one again, kind of had two shots at it. The second one, it was tough to catch. It would have been an absolutely an amazing catch. But again, reality is he should have caught the first one, at least put him in third and one or a first down.
But you know, that's been the case for much of the season too, especially in those three games against the Huskies. The Wildcats coming close, but again, just unable to make those plays when they count.
Yeah, and you're going to have to make those plays if you want to win in this conference.
All right, Zeroni takes the low snap and it gets a wobbler down to about the 40-yard line. It'll bounce and out of bounds, taken there by number 83 for the Thunder, Jaquan Swan. And so no run back. And the Regina Thunder will take the football over at about their own 43-yard line.
Yeah, better punt there. Again, he's trying to get it outside the numbers. He limited the gain to just a few yards and gained some field position. Now onus goes back on the defense, who has been on the field a lot today. They're going to have to come up with a stop here.
All right, single setback. And that looks to be Quinton Ruckabar. Ruckabar in there to block, and the pass is complete on the far side. And it'll take about 3 or 4 Wildcats to wrestle down the receiver, but it is complete, taken by number 21, Greg Lamb, from Aiton Bowman High School in Saskatoon.
Yeah, a little bit of different of offensive look there on that play. They actually had a couple guys lined in at tight end, so you know they were just kind of hunkering down, saying, yes, we're going to give you lots of time to throw. Let's deliver this ball on time, and they were able to do that.
Ethan Houts now back in the backfield after a one-play rest. Motion goes to this side, pass is complete, wide open, and who else but number 80, Christopher Calcutt, and Calcutt just takes off with it, still going, bumps off one Wildcat player, and finally wrestled out of bounds. What a football game that this young man is having.
He is, you know what, he is playing in the system that is really, I mean, they obviously like to throw the ball, we've talked about that. They have a complimentary run game, but you know what, when you're aggressive with your hands to the ball as a receiver, quarterbacks are obviously willing to throw to you, and they're willing to take a risk. You know, sometimes that one wasn't necessarily a risky throw, just gave it time, let him make a play, but he's got a little quick step there, good stiff arm on the DB, and off of the races he goes.
Gainer close to 30, it's first down. In Wildcat territory at the 31-yard line. Rolling to his right, Sitch looks downfield. Now passes short on the sidelines. It is complete to Hakeem Okeya. And Okeya from Pilot Butte, Saskatchewan, picks up the first down with a gain of close to 11 yards.
You know, they went back into that double tight end formation, and then now they moved the pocket. So they gave them lots of time, let the receivers run their complete route and get to the spot they need to get to, and then a great ball delivered right on the sideline to catch and step out of bounds.
First and 10, ball is on the 19-yard line. And again, they go to that tight end formation.
Yeah, they've got some big boys in there giving the quarterback time.
Ethan Houts is, Sitch. Takes the snap but fumbles it. There is a flag on the far side of the field.
I think they're sending one of their DBs or linebackers to try to add to the mix inside, and then I think he was a little bit too quick.
Offside will be the call.
Well, and it's unfortunate for the Cats to not be able to take advantage of the missed fumble in the backfield.
Offside, Edmonton. 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
So it remains first down with 5 yards to go. The ball is on about the, we'll call it the 14-yard line.
You can see the mistake the quarterback made on that replay that just showed. It just took his eyes off the ball a little bit too soon, something you always try to teach those young guys not to do.
Quinton Ruckabar now back in the game. As the lone setback, there's the handoff, or the play action rather. Nice fake, and then the pass complete at about the 10-yard line, and still going with it is number 22, Daniel Borges from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, out of Central High School. And this Regina Thunder team, I was going down the list of players and where they're from before the game. They're from all over Saskatchewan. They don't just pick from Regina.
Well, they have a lot of football being played in Saskatchewan in every nook and cranny of the province, and they obviously love football. They love, obviously, the Riders, and people want to play football in the province, and they're doing a good job getting those bodies on into uniforms.
Three flankers to the far side of the field. Those big farm boys from Saskatchewan, I'll tell you what, they are tough to beat. They've been so successful over the years. There's the play action once again, and the pass is completed to 5, in for the touchdown, untouched. Number 22, Daniel Borges, once again takes his second completed pass and in for the touchdown.
Again, they are using their backs really well out of the backfield, and you'll see on this replay, I believe he starts kind of coming underneath and then leaks out late. You know, he gets engaged with someone, and what that usually does is, you know, usually they have someone responsible for that guy. Once he engages on somebody, that responsibility kind of says, okay, or that personnel who's supposed to be watching him says, okay, he's engaged, now I'm free to go make a play. Mm-hmm. Again, he sneaks out off that block, and then he's wide open, and the guy's in a chase mode and just doesn't track him down.
There's the point after from Reed. It is good. And with 5:01 to go in the first half, it's 41-0 in favor of the Regina Thunder. The Thunder like to use that zone read quite a bit, and they've been very, very successful with it.
Well, and again, we've talked about this year, how teams who can use the zone read really complements a passing game. So they obviously have the passing game that they can do it. The zone read in that case draws everybody and gives them lots of time, you know, easy little pass and catch, and into the end zone he goes. And so, you know, any team in football, if you can be balanced, especially as it gets a little colder, I mean, this game could easily be played while it's snowing, and so you need to be able to do both and not turn one-dimensional.
All right, kickoff from Reed coming from the 45-yard line. He goes short to the sidelines at about the 25-yard line, picked up there. And going absolutely nowhere was the ball carrier, number 80, Brandon Rebnord from Bev Facey High School in Sherwood Park.
And on the tackle there was number 34, Ethan House, a little running back, obviously excited to get down there. You know, he's a big body, looks like he's a little bit more of that fullback build, and so he's getting downfield, great special teams tackle.
Ethan House from Luther College going into this game with 52 carries on offense and a couple of TDs, and also a pretty successful year as far as the special teams are concerned, obviously.
Mm-hmm. And you need those special teams guys to make plays.
Handoff taken by Bray Josu. Josu finds some room, has a hole, needs a block, is going to be run out of bounds, and there's going to be a holding call or an illegal block downfield, and it will go against the Wildcats.
You've got that right, and again, it's just battling to try to get that break, get that extra few yards. Unfortunately, he did not let go in time.
So the holding call, and that'll bring the football back to about the 20-yard line or so.
Holding, Edmonton number 8, 10 yards from the point of foul, result of the play, first down.
Brandon Olson flagged.
Well, a positive for the Cats is that it was after the yards were gained, and so it goes back, still gained a little bit of field position, but more importantly, there's still first down and 10 now.
Mark the ball down at about the 33-yard line. So Bray Josu on that play, able to break it for a few yards. best offensive output so far of this football game, and this time the handoff to Jordan Samuel. Samuel had his feet cut out from underneath him on a nice tackle by number 50, Zach Richardson from Melfort, Saskatchewan.
You know, it takes a lot of work to get the run game going. Not only do the receivers have to get involved, and we refer back to the holding Paul, and that's just a guy working hard trying to get the extra yards. And you've seen Regina, once the running back beats that first level or beats those box players, if you can get bodies on bodies in the secondary, that changes a 10 or 12 yard run into a 30 or 40 yard run.
Latosky into the football game now for the Wildcats. And Erickson is taken down from behind and coming in on the right side untouched from his defensive back position was number 23, John Martin from Balfour High School.
You know, Regina's confident enough in secondary that, again, if the ball's not coming out on time or it's spending too much time in the air when it is released, we can bring that extra guy. Let's not leave a safety back there. Let's put pressure on the young quarterback. Let's put pressure on this O-line who's having a tough time buying time for their quarterback to throw the ball.
So after an encouraging start to this series, the Wildcats will have to kick this one away. Matt Zeroni standing at about his own 10-yard line.
You know, that holding not only cost them 10 yards, but it seemed like it almost cost them the momentum as they just started to get things going. It cost them more than just the 10 yards.
Good spiral kick taken at about the 50-yard line by Marcus Hall. Hall takes off to the outside and then is taken back and is tackled at around the 50. We'll see where they mark it down on his forward motion, but a good tackle coming in from his position was number 52 for the Edmonton Wildcats, and that is Jack Jones from McNally High School, a young rookie, and he's got to be pretty happy with that.
Yeah, if you watch this replay, I am not going to be surprised if the Wildcats run another fake punt at some point in time. You can see on that rush, Regina is not coming very hard. They're trying to set up their return, and there's lots of space for the Wildcats maybe to run a fake at some point in time, which they've done this year already.
All right, first down from the 53-yard line, and passing deep. Man open at about the 25-yard line, complete. And I keep saying it, but who else but Hakim Okeya? And between Okeya and number 80 for the Thunder, Christopher Calcutt, what a combination of pass receivers.
You know what? When you send six guys out and you have time to throw the ball, you're going to find guys in open space. And great ball delivered. And you can see the difference in the delivery. The ball's coming down with a little bit more zip. And if you actually watch a ball closely in a football game, if you see that nose come over a little bit and kind of come down, you have a tighter spiral, it flies better. And so we're not seeing that from the Cats as much, and we're seeing that a lot from the Regina Thunder here.
In the pocket now, Sitch looking into the end zone. It will be well short. And the intended receiver out there was number one, Levi Paul, from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, and that was actually the first wobbly pass that we've seen come from.
Well, you can see in the replay here, that's because he got rocked as he just started to deliver this. It's actually, he's pretty lucky he didn't throw an interception there.
Huge hit on Mr. Sitch.
That's what happens when you come from the blind side. And we talk about the blind side, it means the quarterback's typically looking the other way and doesn't see that coming. So that could have been costly. Fortunately for Regina, it's not.
Ethan Houts back in there at halfback and again being pressured, but this time able to get out of the pocket and take off with the football was Brock Sitch. And he went straight for the sidelines and that first down marker. And it looks like he is going to make it just by about the nose of the football.
Well, when you send guys to get to the quarterback, you've got to make sure, again, we talked about breaking down on special teams. You have to break down in the backfield, because usually when you send extra personnel after your quarterback, if he gets away from that, there's nobody left to make a tackle, hence the first down by Regina. So good job by the quarterback being slippery in the backfield and then converting that into a first down.
Houts is the lone setback. Three flankers to the far side, including a couple of slot backs, two on this side. Everybody downfield, there's the handoff to Houts. Houts trying to string it out to the outside, and he is cut off. And a good job by Jimmy Enns, or James Enns, rather, as he was able to force the ball carrier inside.
Yeah, that's tough, again, in open space. You always want to, if you're the edge guy, you want to make sure you err on the side of keeping him towards the center of the field. If you allow him to get around the edge, then that's obviously where they go for big yards. But good job of rallying and making a tackle, limiting the gain to 5 yards.
Second and five. Ball on about the 8-yard line. Three flankers on this side this time. And there's that quick pass into the end zone. Dahlke is being covered, or rather doing the coverage, and the pass complete. And in for the touchdown was Okea. And for Okea, that's his second of the game.
Well, again, you know what? It wasn't the perfect ball. It wasn't really the perfect route either. But again, the receiver did his best to stay focused. It looked like the ball got tipped up. We'll see here on the replay. Delivered to the, you know, to the corner of the end zone. Got a little bit on it. Maybe a little bit of a push to help him get that ball open. But again, he stayed focused, caught the ball. Things are going Regina's way.
It looked like Dahlke did get turned around a little bit on that coverage. All right. Point after from James Reed. Ball is up, it's through the uprights, and with 1:36 to go in the first half, it's 48-0 in favor of the Regina Thunder. As they say in Regina, Thunder rolls on, and they are indeed rolling on in this football game.
Yeah, and I don't imagine we're going to see a lot less from them as this game continues. You know what, they have a job to do. They're getting ready for the playoffs. You know, you can tell just by the swagger the guys have. You can see on the replay, they are excited to be out here, and you need to have fun while you're playing football. You need to enjoy it, and Regina is really enjoying this, and they want to continue that. They don't want to let that, you know, end. They don't want to stop any momentum because they have a big task next week in the playoffs.
All right, again, stay with us for our halftime show. Kevin Donnan will be busy downstairs. He'll be talking with not only Scott McCauley and Darcy Park, the coaches of these respective teams, but Corbin Sharoon will be in for a little talk about the good old days of the Edmonton Wildcats on this Alumni Day at Clark Park. Now off the kickoff, the Isaiah run back Brown taken by Isaiah Brown once again, and he'll pick up close to about 12 yards on that run back for a first down in Wildcat territory.
Yeah, they're going to have to get things going. And again, first down production is going to be critical if they want to move the ball a little bit here. And then limiting the errors. We've seen almost, no matter how many drives now, have ended on errors, right? Whether it results in a turnover or a penalty that results in long down distances.
Austin Erickson out of Lacombe Composite High School. There's that little sweep play. And a ball taken to the far side of the field by number 82, Dalton Latosky. And Latosky will pick up close to 8 yards. And it'll be second and about 2. Ball on the 36-yard line. And that's something we haven't seen in this game, at least not since the first quarter.
No, that's the first time. And again, that's great first down production, and that's what you need to do. And now they need to execute. Now they need to finish this and get a first down here.
Sam Oyl, the lone setback. There's the handoff, or the fake rather, and the ball is put up, and it is going to be picked off one more time. And again, I believe it was number 2, Taylor Meyer, make it number 3, and that is Ethan Englott seeing action for the first time out of Campbell High School in Regina. And it's just been one of those days for young Austin Erickson, the Lacombe High School graduate, of course, in there replacing Colton Hippie, who is out with a couple of pretty serious injuries, and as well the number three quarterback, rather, Justin Swedish, injured going into this game. So Erickson out there on his own, and the pass complete from Sitch to number 21. Greg Lamb, and Lamb is going to pick up close to 20 yards on that one, and that'll carry the ball into Wildcats territory.
You know what, that's a play you can see just the team speed. You know, Regina is playing at a higher level. They're playing faster, and when you are faster at different positions and overall than a team, it allows plays like that to happen. I mean, he turned a simple 5-yard little route underneath route into a first down.
And when you're talking about speed, you're also talking about size. When you've got offensive linemen at 6'4", 6'4", 6'3", 6'5", and so on and so forth, up over the 300-pound mark, you know that the defense is going to be in tight.
Well, and if you're going to send 6 receivers out, you're going to have a great O-line, and they're doing an outstanding job.
All right, we have a timeout on the field. Injury timeout as one of the Regina players, or make that Wildcat players, is injured at about the 45-yard line. Looks like he's going to be okay. It is number 98 for the Wildcats. There is no 98. So Jamie
96.
96. Jamie Turcotte is the man from Cold Lake, Alberta.
Another place for great fishing up in Cold Lake. I haven't been there, but I need to get up there.
I'll be in, I'm close to that area. On Tuesday, we're going up to do a little fishing for grayling around Fox Creek.
Oh, nice.
Get the old fly rod out. Hope it doesn't ice up too badly. Sitch at quarterback. Out of the shotgun, the pass complete to Houts. He's at the 30, to the 25, still going to the 20. And taken down just over the 20-yard line. So a gain of another close to 30 yards or so. And again, the Thunder moving the ball almost at will against the Wildcats.
You know, you can see, Kevin, you can take a look at the bench down there. There isn't much movement. There isn't much. It's, you know, it is hard to get excited in a game like this, but that bench is cool.
And not only that, but it is very short. They are missing 19 players, the Wildcats are, going into this football game, as we mentioned in the preamble. They couldn't even come up with enough to fill a 65-man roster that the home team has allowed going into this game. There's the pass up the middle, complete again, taken by Greg Lamb. And Lamb is going to pick up about 7 yards. It'll be second and three, ball on about the 10-yard line. Timeout taken by the Regina Thunder. And at this point, you have to ask yourself, why?
Well, you know what? They're working on execution. Again, they're not going to play this game any differently they would play any other game. You know, as an offensive coordinator, as a head coach, I mean, at the end of the half, this is the decision you're going to make. You're in scoring position. You're going to coach the same way you coach in every other game, regardless of the score being up or down. And you know what? That's what the coach is doing. He's making those decisions.
So we're down to the last 16.4 seconds of this first half. And again, a reminder that Kevin Donnan will have a couple of special guests. He'll be talking with Darcy Park.
You know, the other piece the players can learn from an opportunity like this is, hey, we're in the red zone. We have three plays at the very most we need to execute. So he's developing his players to play in those situations, which, again, you don't always get those situations live. So he wants to do that right now.
I've been watching Darcy down at the bench, and he's always up. He's just that kind of guy, and here's a fumble in the backfield. It's taken by Ethan Houts. Houts is trying to outrun the coverage, and the ball comes loose, but it will roll out of bounds, and I believe it was Houts who was the last to touch it. So the Thunder will maintain possession of that football, but a pretty good loss of close to 15 yards on the play, depending on where they mark it. Ball goes out at about the 20, so.
Well, we just talked about that. Lessons that can be learned down on the goal line, right? In a tight game, that's a critical play that they've just lost yards, really taking them out of scoring position from a touchdown standpoint. Now they're going to have to kick a field goal. So again, an opportunity when they go back to film, hey, here's some mistakes that we just made that really, you know, took points off the board.
And for the second time in the football game, Sitch unable to handle that snap.
Yeah, that's twice. And again, they'll take a quick look at that on film and make sure they know where the mistakes are happening and make sure he doesn't make those mistakes again.
Field goal attempt from the 29-yard line. It's going to be well wide. Taken there in the end zone and trying to come out with it, and successfully doing so is number 22. For the Wildcats, that is Isaiah Brown, and Brown runs it up to about the 15-yard line, and so a good run back, and he'll take over possession of the football on the 20.
Well, and you go right back to the lessons learned, right? Miss snap, you know, they lost 15 yards, and then they missed the field goal.
Okay, that is the end of the first half of football here at Clark Park as the Scotch Mist begins to fall a little more heavily on the football field, and with the score being 48-0 in favor of the the Regina Thunder over the Edmonton Wildcats, it just going to be one of those football games where goodness knows the Wildcats will go into the dressing room, and I don't think there's just a whole heck of a lot that Darcy Park can say to his football team. It's just one of those days when the Thunder are just so red hot, and such a great football team as well.
Yeah, and you know what? You mean you talk about those lopsided games. I've been in a number of them. Our league that I coach in is set up where, you know, we're playing, you know, lower end teams and higher end teams to each other. But I've also been on the back end of that as well. It has happened before. And again, as a coach, you never like that. But again, that's a reality.
All right, let's go downstairs. And here is Kevin Donnan.
Thanks a lot, Dave. I am head coach Darcy Park. Darcy, it's a tough one today.
Yeah, I guess our guys are still waiting for the game start. They didn't realize it started at 1 o'clock. But, you know, they had three huge plays in that first quarter, and we couldn't recover. And then Doubt steadied in on our defense, and, you know, we were letting free guys run all over the place. And on offense, it's, you know, the same story it's been all year, where we can't get any first downs to keep our defense off the field and allow them a chance to regroup. And, you know, again, it's all facets. We faked a punt maybe we shouldn't have, and tried to run a reverse that backfired on us. So, I mean, I guess it's pretty much, you know, what's happened all year. And, you know, again, hopefully I've been proud of the way the guys have responded all year. So, ultimately, that's all we can do now in the second half is play the last 30 minutes and hopefully forget about this first 30.
I was going to say throughout this season, and it has been a tough one, but there's something to be said for Wildcat pride, and especially for your young quarterback today. A lot of poise out there, especially when you consider the number of injuries you've got along the offensive line. Austin Erickson has shown a great deal of poise, and he's been under siege all afternoon.
Yeah, he's showing toughness, and we wanted to hopefully let him dip his feet in a little bit, but he gets drilled on the first play of the game, and you know, all of a sudden that maybe, you know, he's hanging on to the ball a little longer or not trusting to get rid of it on time. And, you know, that's something, I guess, that comes with experience. But I'd like to hopefully we protect him a little more in the second half and we can get, again, some positive things going for him.
And on behalf of ICU Video, we want to thank head coach Darcy Park for his access and availability all season. First-class organization and a first-class group to work with, all the way from the players through the coaching staff and the entire organization. So it's been a tough year, but we sure want to thank you.
No, I think, you know, the job you guys have done in terms of getting our league out there has been awesome. I think, it's the caliber of the television is second to none, and, you know, we're just proud to be a part of it. And, again, like I said, hopefully this will be the last time we'll have to do these sad interviews at
Yeah, we want to see that big smile in 2017.
All right,
thanks so much, Coach Park. And back up to Dave and Rob for a look at the stats from the first half.
All right, we're still awaiting the stats, Kevin, but, you know, a little bit of a twinkle in the eye of Darcy Park. The guy is always up. He's such a fun-loving guy.
An incredibly proud guy and a great coach. And as we've seen every one of these games here at Clark Park, but the one constant has always been the ability of these Wildcats to play through adversity and play with a great deal of pride, Dave.
Well, you know, the one thing that he mentioned to me the other night when I was down at practice, Kevin, he has never coached. He says he has never coached a harder working group of players.
You bet.
In spite of the horrendous season that they've had. He says they have never stopped working and have done everything that he's asked them to do. So that's what you like to hear from a head coach, and that's what you like to see from your players.
Poise and Wildcat pride, and I know that Darcy's going to reinforce that in the room here at the half.
All right, let's take a look here at some of the stats. Rob Herod, and as you might expect, pretty much in favor of the Regina Thunder. Total of 437 net yards in that first half. That's almost unheard of.
It is, and you know what? A lot of that has to do with the turnovers. You look at, I think we had five interceptions. Erickson threw five interceptions. You know, not all his fault. And again, some of the blame has to be put on those receivers for making plays. You know what? As a receiver and as a former receiver myself, I always said, you know, give me a chance. Let me make a play for you. And then if you can do that, that gives them the opportunity. They haven't been making the plays, and that's resulting in some of those turnovers. And then, of course, that just puts their offense back on, which really hasn't been stopped today.
This team going into this game, the Regina Thunder, they were billed as a passing team under Sawyer Buettner, one of the top passers in the Prairie Football Conference. Of course, he is not here today. He had a slight knock last week against Calgary, so they left him at home and let him prepare for the playoffs. We'll talk more about the quarterbacking, but right now we're going to go downstairs, and Kevin Donnan has a very special guest.
Thanks a lot, Dave. Welcome back to the sideline at Clark Park and this ICU Video Productions procast of this Prairie Football Conference game between the Regina Thunder and the Edmonton Wildcats. The score at halftime, the Thunder 48, the Wildcats no score. I am pleased to to be joined by my halftime guest, former Eskimo, former Stamp, and former Wildcat, Corbin Sharoon. And Corbin, Coach Park said, when you're ready, all you have to do is suit up.
He said it best right there. So I don't know what's going on right now with the score and stuff like that, but I guess hopefully to come out at halftime with a little bit of a spark or something. So
now in terms of to get the Wildcats back to the, you played in a Canadian Bowl, what's it going to take for this organization to get back to that next level?
I think just a lot of hard work. Kids got to buy into the system. Coaches got to buy into what they're coaching, and everybody's just got to gel together and come into that system together.
Now you've had an incredibly successful year all the way from minor football through the Lords in Skona High School here in Edmonton. And tell us about your career plans going forward now.
Now the football's over. I'm actually my next choice is to apply to the EPS, the Edmonton City Police. So that's going to be my next career, and that's what I'm going for, and that's what I'm going to do. I want to be a police officer. I've always wanted to do that, so now it's time to do it.
And congratulations on your career and on the example you've set for not only the Wildcats playing today but going forward as well. And it's a big day today, an alumni day. It's a great day for you to catch up with some of your former friends and former teammates.
Oh yeah, it's been great. You know, I see some guys over here I haven't seen in a couple of years, and it's been a while, and it's happy to see them, and just happy to catch up. You know, it's, you know, long lost friends, and you know, you're always brothers because you always played together, so you always got that bond. So it's good to catch up.
Well, congratulations on the career. Congratulations on Alumni Day, and best of luck with your career going forward. Appreciate you joining us, and want to thank Corbin Sharoon for joining our ICU video procast here on the sideline. In just a few moments, we'll chat with Scott McCauley, the head coach of the Regina Thunder, as we get ready for the second half. Let's throw things back up to Dave and Rob.
Always enjoyed watching Corbin Sharoon out there on the special teams. Boy, I'll tell you what, he was one of the top tacklers in the CFL back in his day.
You know, he's been a great athlete, a great football player for a long time. I actually was good friends with one of his coaches that coached him back at Skona. And he was actually wondering why, you know, some of the universities out here was not all over him, getting him to go to school. And he ended up going out east, and he promised me that you would see him back someday in the CFL. And sure enough, he came back and made an impact both in university but then in the CFL as well.
I have one word of warning for Corbin, though. If he's going to be a police officer, he's going to have to cut those long blonde locks of his.
Yes, I think he will. He can get away with it as a football player, but maybe not as a police officer.
Seriously, though, the Eskimos and the EPS have had a pretty good reputation together. I mean, in fact, from time to time, the Eskimos will allow the EPS to come in and use their training equipment.
Yeah, they have. And you know what? It's a great relationship. Actually, when I was playing, two or three of our players that I played with and my teammates are police service somewhere, RCMP, and they've also had hockey games that I've played in against the EPS. And so there's definitely a good relationship there throughout the years.
All right, let's go back to what we were talking about statistic-wise. We mentioned 437 total net yards to just 108 for the Edmonton Wildcats. And the big one, of course, for the Thunder is that passing game, 260 yards total passing. And that's just a great afternoon for the young quarterback, Brock Sitch.
Well, I know we probably don't have a quarterback rating calculated. I don't have the math to do that off the top of my head. But when you look at some of the receiver numbers, and we talked about Christopher Calcutt, who, you know, four catches for 96 yards and two touchdowns. They are so effective, you know, when they are throwing the ball. They're running the ball well, which has set up the aerial attack, which obviously with six guys going out of the backfield, you know, he's finding the open spaces, and they are gouging the defense big time.
All right. One thing that does surprise me is the lack of ball time given to Bray Josu in this football game. He's only had the three tackles. He picked up 18 yards. Had a good run back on one of those runs, but other than that, he really hasn't seen all that much action.
Well, it's tough. If your O-line is losing the battle in the trenches, and coaches will always talk about that, you know, they are losing that battle really on both sides of the ball. But if your offensive line are not creating any kind of seams or holes, you know, you can have a dynamic running back. He can only do so much on his own. And so the offensive line are going to have to get bodies on bodies. They're going to have to create a little bit of a seam and allow him to hit the hole hard. And then it comes to the receivers to do those blocking things downfield that actually allows the big plays.
So Jordan Samuel playing in his final game as a junior with the Wildcats with four touches and 12 yards so far gained. When you're in the dressing room and you're knowing that there are six players on this football team who will never play junior football again, can the coaching staff use that as a motivating factor?
Oh, I'm sure they've had. I'm sure they've talked about, you know what, the game is out of hand. But, hey, these graduating players, it may be their last opportunity. So let's play for them. And it's part of the setting of a culture in a football team where you want to create that, where you're supporting the guys as they leave because they're going to be around. They're going to be on the sidelines, just like Corbin was here, you know, helping out, you know, talking to the guys, giving them a little bit of inspiration. But having those alumni stay connected is important, and playing for those guys is also important.
As you mentioned, five interceptions thrown by the young quarterback and for Austin Erickson out of Lacombe. And obviously, you know, with his passing style and the way he's able to put the ball up as high as it is, as he has, it's easily picked off. Is that something that the coaching staff will work with him on the off season?
Oh, there's no question. And again, part of that is comfort. You know, we've seen him step into a throw, deliver a good football, so we know he's capable. It's not like his fundamentals are out the window and he doesn't know how to throw a football. He definitely knows how to throw the football. We just need to get him comfortable in the pocket. And Darcy even talked about that at halftime, like, hey, he's not comfortable. He's throwing off his back foot, and that's why the ball's hanging up in the air. And you add the weather piece to that, and that's...
Yeah, and as you mentioned, too, he has been pressured on almost every play when he's gone back into the pocket. That offensive line having a tough time against those big boys from Saskatchewan.
Yeah, and the one thing that they did a little bit, and maybe we'll see a little bit more of it, they're actually moving the pocket around because he seems to move okay, and then he gets him a little bit more time. He has the option to take off and run if he needs to, which gives him really a choice there when he rolls out.
I talked with Darcy during the week at practice, and you know, going into next year, we know that the Huskies are in good shape as far as their young players are concerned. The Wildcats will lose six players, but they've got a large number of especially second and third year players coming up that really could make a difference for them in the next couple of years.
Yeah, and you know what? They're going to have to continue to build on that. They're going to have to recruit the players. They're really going to have to work on that relationship with the University of Alberta. And the reality is Darcy's going to have to work with Ian because there's players that go back and forth from different organizations. And with two junior teams in Edmonton, we definitely have the talent here to support that and have quality teams. Now they've got to get them in pads and on the field. And one of the things as a you know, a coach learning, okay, what do I need to do to maintain a program? He's got to see into the future really to say, okay, what kind of players are we bringing into our organization and how are we developing them? So you can get them as great players, but if you don't develop them, they won't turn into great junior players. Or if, you know, you get them out of high school and their ceiling is still not reached, how do we get them to that ceiling quickly so they can be an impact player for 2 or 3 years on a junior program?
Speaking of impact players, we're just down on the field, and I was just noticing the Edmonton Raiders, as we mentioned during the football game, a bunch of young Bantam football players, and they're out there, and they're kind of playing a little scrimmage. It's a six-man game, and you're very well familiar with that game.
Oh, I love seeing those guys out there. Actually, Darcy, myself, Ian, and a number of their football people kind of in northern Alberta have been getting together over the years a few times a year at a summit, trying to work on the development of football players. The number of players playing football and continuing even into high school and beyond has been dropping over the years. So like, well, what is it? We're looking into those types of things. And that in and of itself, those initiatives that create, you know, more teams, more players on the field, that's going to create more football players, a better passion for the game. And in essence, you know what? That's going to build for those junior and university teams. And that's what Darcy is needing to be a part of.
And a young budding quarterback with a completed pass down there. So that's great news. And, you know, in this six-man game, and you're very, very familiar with it, how is the popularity going?
You know what? It's increasing. It's a lot of fun for the kids.
All right, let's go downstairs once again. Here's Kevin Donovan.
Thanks so much, Dave. I am here with Regina Thunder head coach Scott McCauley. Scott, you've got the most dangerous team in the Prairie Football Conference right now. This team is peaking at the right time.
You know, we've been talking to our guys about that all year. It's a process, right? We're a real young team. We knew that we're going to have some of our lumps and bumps along the way and face some of our injuries. But if we just keep focused and kept on getting better each week, good things will happen, and hopefully we can keep it going.
Now, Calcutt, Okiah, and Sitch today, I mean, they're just playing pitch and catch right now.
Yeah, they had a great first half, and unfortunately, we know we're going to be sitting all of them here right away. But we expect other guys to step up here right away and keep the flow going.
All right, good luck next week in the playoffs, and thanks so much.
All right, thanks.
Let's send things back up to Dave Rozak and Rob Harrod, who will bring you the second half of this contest between the Regina Thunder and the Edmonton Wildcats. Gentlemen.
I like the way Scott McCauley has is managing his football team. As he mentioned to you, we probably won't be seeing much of the three receivers that have been so successful, including Okea, in that first half. And obviously, he wants to get some of his youngsters out there and give them a chance to display their wares.
Yeah, you know, that is part of building a program, not just a team for a year, but building a program. You know, when you have the opportunity to get the young guys in without sacrificing kind of the annual goals, really getting the young players in so they can get the experience and have success on the field.
And you always like to watch the attitude of the teams as they come out of the dressing room, and just watching downfield here at just below us, the Edmonton Wildcats, obviously motivated once again by their head coach, Darcy Park, and ready to get out there and give it the best they can.
Sometimes as the head coach, one of the toughest things is to know you have to stay on the sideline. You cannot put the pads on anymore. And so you work at your strategies. Okay, how do I get the fire that I once had as a player into these guys to get them excited about playing, you know, in a game that at this point is out of hand? How do you get them up? How do you get them going to play this second half of football? And Darcy, you know, had some great words for his players out in the dressing room at halftime.
48-0 is the score in favor of the Regina Thunder over the Edmonton Wildcats. And sitting back at about his 10-yard line and ready to take the kickoff from Matt Zeroni will be number 21 for the Regina Thunder, and that is Greg Lamb, who's had a pretty good first half, the Aiden Bowman graduate. Going into this game with a total of 15 receptions, he's picked up two or three so far in this game. And the kickoff coming from the 45-yard line, and actually out there to perform the kickoff is number 44, Kieran Bell. It's a good kick down to about the 25-yard line and rolled back to about the 30. The Regina Thunder will take over the football, and a tough run back, a good run back though, by number 21, Greg Lamb.
And you could see on the return team, Regina knowing that Edmonton's probably going to try to get a spark. They actually had 10 of their 12 players up pretty close to that 10-yard mark, making sure to take away any type of short kick option, because again, they've seen film, they know Edmonton, they know the Wildcats will try that.
All right, first down from the 35-yard line. Brock Sitch still in at quarterback for the Thunder, back in the pocket now, looking downfield, moves out of the pocket, fires over the head of the intended receiver. Out there it was number 82, and that is Lee Brown, who is getting his first action of the game, a second year graduate of Campbell High School in Regina.
Yeah, ball's delivered a little bit high, but again, Regina is not changing anything. They're sending six receivers out. They're challenging the secondary. They're challenging the front four of the Wildcats to see if they can get to the quarterback.
Lone setback is Ethan Houts. He comes out of the backfield. There's the pass up the middle and incomplete. The ball is bouncing around. There's no whistle, and it'll be recovered by the Wildcats. Not exactly sure what happened there, but it didn't look like he had full control. We'll see this on the replay.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised they called that a catch. I think with if they had the same replay angle we did, they probably would have ruled it incomplete. But nonetheless, they don't have replay at junior yet, and the Cats are on the field with their offense.
All right, it is a first down for the Wildcats. Ball on the 34-yard line. There's the handoff to Samuel. Samuel has some room, gets into the backfield, and is finally taken down at about the 17-yard line, and a pickup of close to 12 yards, and that time all kinds of room for Jordan Samuel.
Yeah, we talked about it at half. If the offense can give them a little bit of space, they've got the talent in the backfield to make it. You can see on this run, there's like one arm tackle only, and then it was into second level, so that gained the first down.
A good start offensively for the Edmonton Wildcats, but now there is a flag.
I hate to put it on the receivers, but it was the receivers. They obviously either heard the snap count was different or just jumped the gun, but they were definitely downfield before they should have been.
All right, it is going to be a time count violation, it appears, against the Wildcats.
Offside, Edmonton, number 81, 5-yard penalty remains.
I stand corrected. I guess they must have been lined up offside from what I can figure. Hakuna Vanu.
Oh, he was running across the line. He's about 5 yards downfield without the snap being taken yet.
All right, there's the snap and the handoff to Bray Josu, and Josu is piled up in the backfield, and in there to make the tackle was Matt Williams from Lumsden, Saskatchewan.
Yeah, again, you can see the total difference there, right? First play, offensive line got their block. Second play, you know, free guy in the backfield, another couple guys to help, and so they've got to make sure they pick up their blocks.
Out there on the offensive line getting some action, third-year man Spencer Barrett, number 45, along with Carson Bell from Assiniboia, Saskatchewan. This is Erickson. Back in the pocket, firing it is picked off at the goal line. And the sixth interception of the football game, and really a well-thrown pass. It was intended out there for Tristan Schultenkamper. I thought he had it there for a minute, but a good defensive play.
You know what? Yeah, I agree with you. It was a much better delivered pass, tighter spiral, and you can see as it comes out of the pocket, he's just got to get it out there a little bit further, and maybe it's an arm strength thing. Again, DB did a better job adjusting than the receiver in that case, and again, it turned out to be another interception.
That'll bring the ball out to the 20-yard line, and that's where the Regina Thunder will start things off with 12:18 to go in the third quarter, leading by a score of 48-0. Back in the pocket now, Sitch runs out of it. He's got some room, but he decides to throw instead. Why not? Wide open along the sidelines there at about the 40-yard line, up to the 50, and a gain of over 30 yards. And wise decision and a great eye by the quarterback, Brock Sitch, in that completion to number 83, Jakin Swan.
Yeah, we've got a flag in the backfield in the area of the holding, so I'm not sure if that's what it will be, but it looks like everybody's coming back.
Regina.
There we go.
10-yard penalty remains first down.
Break for the Edmonton Wildcats as they force the Thunder back to about their own 10-yard line.
I think it was one of the old linemen almost that tackled the defensive lineman, so good break and to bring back a big play.
Sitch with the single, setback being Ethan Hotz. There are four receivers to this side of the football field. Back in the pocket, looking into the middle. The pass is complete to Houts out of the backfield. He's at the 20, 25, 30, cuts into the middle and is taken down just over the 40-yard line. In there to help on the tackle was Tony Sabchuk coming up from his safety position.
And it looks like he's down on his knee there, but man, what a great athlete he is. He's, you know, built like a fullback, but he really runs like a tailback. He actually outrun a number of the defensive guys to the sideline to get, you know, a first down on a first and 20. That's an outstanding job.
And this could be some tough news for the Regina Thunder as Ethan Houts, their number two running back, is down on the field. They look like they're attending to his right ankle. He appears to be in a bit of pain too.
Yeah, he got up initially, started to walk, and he was kind of had a limp on, so it doesn't look like hopefully it'll be too bad. What they don't want is another injury going into the playoffs, especially an athlete like that out there.
All right, the athletic therapist doing some stretching exercises on that ankle.
I think the concern here, guys, is if it's a high ankle sprain. Of course, there are different degrees of ankle sprains, but I think the concern right now is just getting him, getting that ankle stabilized right now.
Ethan Houts, as I mentioned, their number two running back so far this season, behind Victor St. Pierre, and of course St. Pierre hasn't seen any action since the first quarter.
Yeah, they're definitely going to rest him, and they want to get the other guys some reps. He looks like he's up and walking off, which is great news for them.
So it'll be first and 10. Ball is on the 43-yard line for the Regina Thunder. Quinton Ruckabar in at halfback, waiting for Houts to come off the field. The Thunder coming out of the huddle with three flankers to the far side of the field. One on this side. Everybody out of the backfield looking downfield. Once again, there's the pass into the middle. It is almost picked off. And coming up from his cornerback position was Brady Kerr, and he was very close to picking that one off.
Yeah, dangerous pass. They actually had two receivers running really head-to-head in that, and that brings the defenders there, so there's a lot of traffic. Very difficult catch to make from a receiver standpoint because you know there's a lot of bodies around you, and you actually don't necessarily know who it's for.
11 minutes left in the third quarter. Flankers out to this side of the field, number 83 is Jakin Swan. There's the snap, a little wide, but it was picked off by Sitch, and now he fires it downfield. It is going to be complete, but I believe there'll be an offensive interference call against Levi Paul as he appeared to push the defender. Just as the ball got there.
Yeah, I think you're right on. I think that's going to be the call. We'll see here in a sec from the officials. But the DB was definitely in the best position to catch that, and the receiver cannot run through him. And he's got the DB has the right to his space as well.
It will be offensive interference. That'll bring the ball back deep into Regina territory if they do decide to accept the penalty. They do. 15 yards.
Not necessarily. Oh,
okay. Pass interference. Regina, number one. 15 yard penalty. Remains first down. Second down.
Remains second down.
Not necessarily what Regina wanted, but the reality is it would have likely been a turnover one way or another. So again, sometimes on the defense, a DB's going to grab a guy, hold a guy, knowing he's beat to save a touchdown. Well, in that case, you know, I mean, it's saving that turnover because it looked like he was going to secure that quite easily.
Quinton Ruckabar still in there at halfback. They went into a tight end formation. There was the handoff, but the flags fly before the snap of the ball. Procedure will be the call against the Regina Thunder.
You know, and these are maybe some of the small mistakes that you get when you have a few younger guys in there trying to learn the system. You mean this Regina system is definitely not a simple system. It's got a lot of guys moving in a lot of directions, creating motion, motioning into, like as you mentioned, the tight end set. You know, that creates a little bit of challenges for the young guys. So the young guys are going to have to get the reps in now.
Cole Ghostkeeper out for, I believe, the first time this season at cornerback. Playing the zone, and there's the pass into the middle. It is going to be complete over the center field stripe and taken down just shy of the 50-yard line was number 84, 83 rather, Jakin Swan. Or we don't have an 84 on our list here, but nevertheless, a completed pass.
One more receiver catching balls downfield for Regina. And you know what, Yask, as a coach, there's not many second and 30 plays you have. They just converted a second and 30, which is really an amazing feat for any offense to be able to do.
Sean Renouf, the receiver on that one. There's the direct snap. It is taken by Ruckabar, and he is tackled behind the line of scrimmage. And in there quickly was Kieran Bell. And that'll be a loss of about 4 yards.
You know what? That's just a one-on-one battle that was won by one of the Cats against us, against tackle. He beat him one-on-one, quick enough to get into the backfield and make a tackle in the backfield. Nice tackle for a loss.
So they mark the ball at the 54. It'll be second and 14. And there is a timeout. On the field,
Regina
calling the timeout.
They're taking the timeout. And the Wildcats would like to recognize the Canadian Junior Football League sponsors. They include
8:51 to go in the third quarter.
Helix and Sports,
48-0 in favor of Regina Thunder. And again, you have to ask yourself, why would they call a timeout?
You know, like I said, you're gonna call the game like you always call it, right? And if it requires a timeout to clarify something, to get a play in, make sure your quarterback's on the right page, you're still trying to execute. As an offense, your young guys may need a little bit more time. You still want to execute. You want to teach the young guys to do that and do their job and understand their job. And so that's why they do it. And again, they want to get a first down. They don't want to go third down and punt here. They want to continue because you know what? The young guys don't get all the playing time all year.
You know,
so they want to keep those drives alive.
You know what scares me? Some of the first and second year guys that they've brought in on that offensive line are almost as big as the veterans that they've been playing for the first half. There's the pass, and again into the middle, but over the head of the intended receiver, Sean Renouf. And the Edmonton Wildcats defense will hold. And with third down and 14, the Thunder will have to kick this one away.
They will, and Edmonton got the stop they wanted to, and now they can get the ball back in the hands of their offense.
I'm curious to see as to whether Brandon Olson will get a shot at quarterback before this game is over. It's been, 3 years since he quarterbacked the Rebels in Jasper Place.
I'm guessing he hasn't taken a lot of reps in the backfield, so I'm not sure he will.
All right, this one is almost blocked, and there's going to be a roughing the kicker call against the Wildcats, and this one's going to go back, and the Regina Thunder will have an opportunity to continue on offense. In there quickly, hitting the kicker was Tony Sabchuk.
Yeah, and Tony came firing off the edge, timed his release really well, unfortunately didn't get there, and then he kind of curled down. Now, I know kickers are a special breed. I'm not sure that hit actually knocked him down, but he did a good acting job. We'll see here.
And it was actually Quentin Ruckabar in there attempting that that punt. Got a good one away, too.
Well, he did enough to sell it for the officials to throw the flag, so that's sometimes the kicker's job.
Unnecessary roughness, roughing the kicker. Edmonton, number two. Unnecessary roughness, Edmonton, number two. 30 yards from the previous line of scrimmage, first down.
30 yards from the line of scrimmage, a pair of unnecessary roughness calls against Tony Sabchuk, and uncharacteristically undisciplined of him.
You have 0-9-5-0-4-5-4.
Well, we saw the first one, but we didn't get a chance to see the second. You are calling.
I know, they're starting to protect players downfield on stuff like that, and that's likely what happened there.
All right, Sitch, handoff. I'd rather play action, the pass in the middle, once again complete, and into the end zone for the touchdown, Levi Paul. It's been a tough afternoon for that linebacking core. The receiver's able to get in behind them, and again, a perfect example.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see on the replay. Tony Sabchuk seemed like he was coming flying up out of the free safety position, and then he was kind of bailing once he realized the guy was going by him, so we should get a good look here. Great play action to hold the linebackers and create the space. And then there's Tony taking off back, trying to get there to make a play.
And in for the touchdown, Levi Paul with his first of the football game from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, out of A.E. Peacock High School. Going into this game, 35 receptions for about 400 yards and four TDs. That is his fifth of the season.
Glad to hear he's making a name for Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. I happen to be born there, so the big moose in Moose Jaw is paying off, and he's making ripples in the Junior Football League. I'm excited about that.
You've been everywhere, haven't you?
Well, you know what? I've traveled quite a bit. I have traveled quite a bit.
Boy, Ottawa, Moose Jaw, Prince Albert.
Yes. Well, my dad was a pilot in the military, so all the military stops is where we've tended to be, so...
You weren't one of those guys that lived in Rockcliffe, were you?
Nope, haven't been there. I've been there, haven't lived there.
All right, here's the kickoff from the 45-yard line. It'll be down to about the 15, and taken there by number 22, Isaiah Brown. And Brown with a good run back of close to 12 yards. And they'll mark it down just over the 35-yard line. So the Wildcats offense back on the field.
Ethan Englund. a good measure on a kick return is really using that 35-yard marker as that spot. You know, sometimes when you get a field goal kicked on, you have the choice, take it on the 35 or take your return. So that's kind of the measure. So if you can get out past the 35 on a return, that's a pretty good return.
Bray Josu back in at halfback. Austin Erickson going all the way in this football game at quarterback. Three flankers to this side. There's the handoff to Josu. And Josu is piled up at the line of scrimmage. There's a fumble. I believe it's going to be blown down, but there will be a loss on the play of close to 3 yards or so. Little extracurricular activity going on after the whistle. And that's something you really have to guard against in a game like this, where it's 55-0 in favor of the Thunder, and the discipline factor becomes so important.
Well, and especially for the Regina team, you mean they know they have to play another week, and they know the Cats aren't going to be playing next week, so guys are going to be playing with emotion. They're going to be leaving it out on the field, as they would say, and again, that can sometimes lead to injury. So you want to make sure that, one, you're protecting yourself, and you honor the game by playing full speed every play if you're on the field.
Sam Oyl in there blocking, and there's the pass, and boy, I'll tell you what, quarterback Austin Erickson was just clobbered as he got the football away, and in there to make that tackle was Spencer Barrett, another Moose Jaw grad.
Well, we've got all sorts of great things coming out of Moose Jaw today. Again, coming on that blindside blitz, quarterback didn't see him, didn't have a chance to get the ball out before, so.
Looks like he may have gotten the worst of it too. Barrett is down on one knee being looked at by the training staff.
Well, if he's from Moose Jaw, I'm sure he'll be back up on the field quickly.
Guys, Kevin here down on the sideline just took a stroll over to the Regina Thunder side of the field, and no surprise, Callcut and Okaya both have the ball caps on, have the jackets on, and they're taking the rest of the afternoon off as they get ready for next week. And whether they'll travel to Saskatoon or to Calgary, but either way, the Thunder and the Huskies, two of the hottest teams in the PFC, heading into next week's semifinals. Two very dangerous teams, guys.
Yeah, thanks, Kevin. You know what? I totally agree with you. You mean two teams that are really kind of peaking at the right time, and so they're gonna have a great opportunity next week to knock off some of the top couple teams in the league to have a chance to move on in the playoffs.
I know, talking with Ian McLean yesterday after last night's game, and fairly confident of meeting Calgary, and I think he'd actually like to meet the Calgary Colts after beating them last night here at Clark Park. But again, we need to await the result of the Saskatoon-Winnipeg game going on as we speak. There's a good spiraling punt taken down at the 35-yard line, and a good run back coming to the far side of the field. It is Marcus Hall, and Hall will run that one back close, about 20 yards or so. But a really good punt from Cerrone.
Yeah, a great punt. Hang time, let his cover team get down there. Now he'd make a few guys miss, but again, the illegal blocks, I think, is going to bring it back. And so great exchange of field position there for the Cats.
I tell you what, Matt Cerrone has been waiting for that punt for the entire football game. He's had a tough go of it with a couple of shanks and some wobblers up there, but that one he's got nothing to complain about.
Yeah, beautiful punt.
6:12 to go here in the third quarter. As I mentioned, 55-0 in favor of Regina. And, you know, with the score being the way it is, the Thunder have to be particularly careful about the injury situation going into the playoff game. I would suspect that when you've got a lead like this, you kind of want to relax a little bit, wouldn't you?
Well, you want to relax in the sense, as a coach, you want to protect some of your players that are possibly at risk of injury. And so I think it's important that, one, they do get their young guys in, and they've talked about that, about getting the young players in. So you still expect your young players to play at full speed, because injuries usually happen when you're not doing that.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, so they've got to make sure they're executing at full speed, you know, to reduce the risk of any kind of injuries going to the playoffs.
All right, change in quarterback. There's the handoff to Ruckabar, and the new quarterback in there for Saskatchewan, or Regina rather, is Chris Campbell out of Centennial High School in Saskatoon.
when you can see they used kind of that fullback that lined up almost a yard off the line like a tight end. He actually came right in this, I think it was the strong A gap, and he was the guy, he was the body on middle linebacker. So they blow everybody else up with their old lineman, bring that fullback in from the edge to take the linebacker, and that's what created space in the middle.
And that's the advantage of having a huge offensive line.
It is. It definitely helps.
You're able to do that. There's the snap, and it looks like it's going to be a time count violation. That snap actually almost went by the quarterback.
It was either time count or procedure. It looks like the snap actually came up late.
Procedure. Regina, number 55. 5-yard penalty.
So movement along the offensive line.
I think all four guys other than the center actually tried to move and then stop themselves from moving. It was an easy call to make by the side judges.
All right, they'll move it back 5 yards. It's going to be first down and 15. Ball on about the 36-yard line. The Wildcats showing blitz. Now they'll back off and use that four-man rush. Here's the long pass all the way down to the 40-yard line and complete down there to number 82, and that is Lee Brown. And with Chris Campbell in at quarterback, they just keep coming at you. This guy is the number three quarterback on their team.
Yeah, and you know what? They're making plays downfield. It's a great ball, great coverage by the DB, and the free safety came over and had a chance to be part of that play, but the receiver making plays. They have a great group of receivers out here. Now we're looking at some of their backup guys continuing to make plays.
Three flankers on this side. There's the pitch out to Ruckabar. Ruckabar takes to the outside and is stopped after a gain of close to 4 yards or so. All right, they'll mark it down exactly on the 40-yard line.
After a gain of 5 yards.
And make that the 38-yard line, 37-yard line. Gain of close to five. Back in the pocket, Campbell fires, complete. Just short of the first down. Receiver out there was Lee Brown once again.
You know, we talked about a talented Regina team here all night, and again, this afternoon, I guess, in this receiving core, I haven't seen many of them drop any balls that were catchable. And when you're a quarterback, whether you're a first-string guy or a third-string guy, when you have that much confidence, you can see lots going on and the receiver's really making plays.
All right, third and one. They're going to go for it. Hand off to Ruckabar. Ruckabar finds some space and plows ahead for a gain of close to 7 yards, down to about the 25-yard line or so. And another first down for the Regina Thunder.
Handing it off behind that big O line is a recipe for success.
Number 45 of the Wildcats, Jeremy Fagan, making the tackle once again.
First and 10 from the 25. Chris Campbell at quarterback here in the third quarter. Looking into the end zone, puts it up, and it is going to be picked off by Jaden Dahlke. Dahlke will be taken down in the end zone. And Jaden, I guess, kind of making up for a couple of mistakes early in that first half, coming up with his second pick of the game.
Yeah, that was a nice little play. Again, eyes on the ball, had an opportunity to make a play. Not sure where the receiver was. It looked like it was two Wildcats actually fighting over that one.
It may have been intended down there for number 82, Lee Brown, but possible mix-up in the route or...
I think it was one of the linebackers that looked like got in his path, and so the timing was a little bit off. And again, when you have a young quarterback throwing the ball to a spot, receiver didn't get there, and two DBs did.
So the Wildcats will take the ball over on their own 20-yard line. Austin Erickson out of that hurry-up huddle. Play action, being rushed. Now he gets out of the pocket, takes off with it, tries to find some room on the outside, and is taken down from behind after a gain of perhaps a yard or so on the play. But nice move by, again, Spencer Barrett, getting into that backfield and chasing down the quarterback.
Well, and Regina's sticking to their game plan. They obviously had a plan to put pressure on the quarterback, and they're continuing to bring the guys off the edge. And they're continuing to believe in their DBs that they can go man up and not have a big problem downfield. So I think the Cats are going to look to get rid of the ball.
Erickson makes it back to the line of scrimmage. There's the play action pass, and we have a man open on this side, just unable to haul it in. Was the receiver down there, number 16, getting some action for the first time in this game, and that is Brendan Gardner, or make that Gwendol Brioch Altersitz, my favorite name of all time in football.
They did a good job trying to use the play action to buy a little bit of time. He had to flip his hips pretty quickly to get his feet set to deliver the ball. He actually delivered a really nice ball on a timing route on the out, just couldn't quite connect.
Matt Zeroni to kick this one away, standing at about his own 5-yard line. Will we see a fake? Not this time. Another good kick. He'll sideline it to about the 50-yard line. It'll be taken there by Hall, and Hall is stopped quickly after a run back of about 3 yards or so. And in there on that tackle was number 80, Brandon Rudnor.
Guys, Kevin here down on the sideline. I have an update from Winnipeg. The final score, the Saskatoon Hilltops 44, the Winnipeg Rifles 14. So for the PFC semifinals next week, we will feature the Battle of Alberta and the Battle of Saskatchewan. Gentlemen?
Just the way it should be. No question about it.
Yeah, that battle never gets old at any level. It's good to see.
Timeout. Edmonton.
And then we'll have a Battle of the Prairies the following week.
That's right. Yeah.
So head coach Ian McLean will now begin preparations for the rematch against Calgary, of course, and the Regina Thunder in the Hilltops. That will be a war in Saskatoon.
You know, I'm kind of happy for Ian because I think that's exactly the matchup that he wanted for his football team in the semifinal next weekend down in Calgary. We have a timeout on the field with 1:06 to go here in this third quarter.
You've got to think this defense of the Wildcats are getting tired. They have been on the field a lot. That was a very short break after they get the turnover. It was a two and out, quick punt, and they're back out there. So they're going to be having a tough time here finishing this one off.
Again, the Thunder was deep in the Wildcats territory with Chris Campbell at quarterback. There's the play action. Campbell is hit just as he got the football away. It was intended once again for number 84 out there, Sean Renouf,
and at number 70 of the Wildcats, Travis Lou.
Campbell is rocked.
And I think it was Travis Love that was in there in a hurry, did a good job of disrupting that play, and they need more of that play from their defensive line. They can't always afford to send at guys, but their defensive line win the one-on-one battles, and he did there and made a big difference for defense.
Travis Love, also one of those playing in his last game of junior football. Now back in the pocket and almost taken down before he could get away was the quarterback, but the pass was complete rather, and taken there by Jacob Swan. And boy, I'll tell you what, Chris Campbell was lucky to get that one away. He was being hurried and hit hard in the backfield by Zach Peterson.
Well, they tried the same recipe. Let's add one off the edge, get some pressure on the quarterback. Unfortunately, they couldn't rally tackle to eliminate the first down, and so they've got the yards now, and here they go.
Ball on the 19-yard line, first and 10. Final 2 seconds of this third quarter. Ruckabar, the lone setback. There's the handoff. He has some room in the middle. Going to the fives, taken down at about the 4. And in there to make the tackle was Jaden Dahlke once again.
Coming back with that kind of inside zone read. We talked about that again. Bodies on bodies. You know, he made one guy miss in the backfield. The second linebacker just got enough of his shoelace to keep him out of the end zone.
Gain of 16. It'll be first and goal, and that is the end of the third quarter here at Clark Park. The score, the Regina Thunder 55 and the Edmonton Wildcats no score. And as you just heard earlier from Kevin, a big win for the Saskatoon Hilltops, and they will be taking part in this Battle of Saskatchewan against this very same Regina Thunder's team. And the Thunder coming off a huge win last week and then an equally big win this afternoon, and we can assume that they're going to win this one. So it's going to be a great matchup. And while we've got a minute here, just want to mention that the Wildcats Football Club would like to thank the following supporters: WestJet, JC Boiler Service, Rough Rider International, On the Rocks, McElhaney, TD Insurance, Flamin Fitness, Dental Choice, the Edmonton Eskimos Football Club, and Commonwealth Stadium as well.
Maybe a shout out to the city of Edmonton for getting this field in playing condition after the heavy snowfall, because I know, you know, footing hasn't seemed to be a problem here, and I know down on field level there's been a little bit of a miss, but not many guys slipping, maybe impacting the ball a lot, but when you have proper footing because of the quality of the field and the preparation, it's always a nicer football game as a player.
We were here last weekend in the middle of a small snowstorm and a whole lot of fog at the same time. It was tough to see the lines at that time, but boy, I'll tell you what, the next day it was nice and clean for the soccer team as they came out here and played.
Well, if they can get the snow off the field, just a little bit of mild temperature, which again, during the day it is, it kind of eliminates anything that's left on there. So that's always nice to have quality fields.
And this is such a great turf. It's such a great move for them to put the turf in here a couple of years ago, that rubber-based turf.
Yeah, no, it is a phenomenal turf to play on, especially at this time of year. You know, during the summer, yeah, nice grass is fabulous, but when it gets cold, you start having to clear snow. Snow doesn't clear off of grass nearly as well as it does come off of this.
Remember the old AstroTurf, and boy, I'll tell you what, when that froze, that hurt.
Well, you can just get metal shovels to clear that one off, and it comes off.
There's the snap. It almost goes wild. The handoff is to Ruckabar, and Ruckabar hurdles a couple of players and into the end zone for the touchdown.
That's number 30.
Another great hole created by the O-line. Couple of bodies on the ground that he had to hurdle over, but did a good job keeping his feet. Didn't want to be denied that time.
And a shaky snap once again that almost went wide, but Chris Campbell did really well to haul that one down, and hand it off to Ruckabar for the touchdown. Here's the point after from James Reed. And it is through the uprights. And so with 14:51 to go in the fourth quarter, the score is the Regina Thunder 62 and the Edmonton Wildcats nothing. I feel like we should go to a commercial break at this point. But
a commercial break would be good.
There you go. Good look at the running ability of Quinton Ruckabar. Ruckabar, a 21-year-old in his fourth year. He'll make that second year from Weyburn, Saskatchewan. So again, the Regina Thunder able to pick from all over the province. Kickoff by Reed. It'll come down to about the 20-yard line, and they try that little flea flicker again. The shovel pass taken by Dahlke, and Dahlke runs it up for a gain of about maybe 10 or 12 yards.
Well, and I often tell my players, you usually only have one opportunity for those types of trick plays. And again, second time running it, Regina had a couple extra guys on the backside to kind of snuff it out. Still a pretty decent return, but again, something that they can build on.
So the Wildcats take it over. Ball is on their own 33-yard line. Erickson, there's the play action again. Pass, it is incomplete and right through the hands of the intended receiver out there, Gwendolbriak Altersitz.
That's number 6 of the Thunder, Cade Kubak.
Another example, you know what, the receivers are going to have to make plays for their quarterback. And that's one that just got away from them.
A lot of zip on that football, though. Well thrown by Erickson.
Well, like we've said, we know he can throw a nice ball, and that's what he needs to do more, is have time to set his feet and deliver on time.
Into the middle again. It is complete to Luther Hakunavenu. Hakunavenu is going to go all the way for the touchdown. Luther Hakunavenu.
Well, great job using his hands to catch the ball, sees the opening, and then yaks. The yak yards is always important. He did a great job using his athleticism, get into space, and then had some blocks from his receivers to get to the end zone. Those are the kind of plays that Darcy wants all his players to make more and more.
And for Hakuna Vanu, his fifth touchdown of the season. And that puts the Wildcats on the scoreboard. Maybe that'll give them a bit of a lift for the rest of this football game.
Well, it's a great example of, again, we talked about the things that need to happen for plays to be successful. You know, the offensive line gave him time to deliver the ball. He used his hands, caught the ball as he's expected to do. And then the receivers helped with a few blocks downfield using his athleticism to get to the end zone. So something definitely to build off of. And here we can go. I think they're going to go for 2 points to get an extra offensive rep in.
Brandon Rednord was injured on that play, but he comes off under his own steam. Erickson going for the 2 points. Four receivers to this side of the field. Erickson rolls that way, the pass incomplete and intended on the goal line for number 33, Lucas Howe, seeing his first action from Archbishop O'Leary High School.
Yep, it's good to get the young guys out there, get them some reps, and they're gonna have to take advantage of those opportunities and secure that catch.
And that really, as Coach Darcy Park mentioned, all season long, that's been the issue, taking advantage, getting the job done.
Yeah, and most coaches talk about in the course of a game, you know, I mean, this is back dating me a little bit, but Don Matthews used to always say 7 plays in a game are really going to determine the outcome. And you know what? It's who's going to make the plays. And, you know, we've seen one great play by the Wildcats, obviously, resulting in a score. Unfortunately, 6 other plays have been happening or more on the Regina side where they're just making play after play. And so the Wildcats are just going to have put a lot of work in the offseason.
All right, out there to do the kickoff honors is Zach Peterson, giving Matt Zeroni a bit of a break. Peterson gets a good low spinning ball all the way down to about the 10-yard line. And here's a chance for the Thunder to run it back.
Ball's
and,
out.
The ball is out.
And it looks
fumbled.
Like the Cats
it's
have it.
It's going to be picked up at the 20-yard line. In for the touchdown, Matt Zeroni. And that may well be the first real big mistake we've seen from this Regina Thunder team. Greg Lamb took that low driving kick and had a good run back, but he ran into a couple of Wildcat players and the ball came out. Matt Zeroni was Johnny on the spot.
Well, and you know what? That's a sign that, you know what, the Wildcats are not giving up. Darcy's continuing to motivate his guys to make plays, and you know, one play can lead to another. And again, if we would have had this a little bit earlier in the game, who knows what the final score would have been if a little bit of momentum would have stayed with the Cats.
And Zeroni owes special thanks to the blocking of number 4, James Enns. Just as he was picking up the ball, Enns was able to take care of one of the potential Regina tacklers.
Yeah, and again, working together as a team, you need everybody to do the job. Special teams guys, offensive guys. They're on the 2-point convert again. Ball a little bit underthrown, and we've seen that over the course of the game. Erickson's been delivering the ball. Some are nice, some are a little bit floating, but they've been underthrown, not allowing the receivers just to run to the corner there as Hakavanu had an opportunity to convert on that. Just the ball was underthrown again.
All right, so with 13:43 to go. And we take a look at that run back again from Matt Zeroni. 13:43 to go in the fourth quarter. It is 62-12 in favor of the Regina Thunder. And you know, I mentioned the word relax, and perhaps Regina Thunder may be just a little bit too relaxed.
And they could, right? And that can be inexperienced because again, they're gonna have some more backups in and you know, you never know what to pin that on. And again, you want to always fight against that, but it's also a balance. The coaches know the bigger picture. They also understand, hey, you know what? We got to survive next week as well.
And these players know that they have a big playoff game coming up next week. And of course, they don't want to be injured. There's no question about that. There's another good kickoff along long, low type of kick that goes into the end zone, and a good job of bringing it out by number 83, Jaken Swan.
Oh, great job of, you know, I mean, when things are going well, they seem to go really well for the Wildcats. And this one, he kicked it right over the head of both returners and really put Regina into some pretty deep field position in their own end.
They run the ball out to the 19-yard line. And with 13:30 to go, it's the Regina Thunder in their own zone with Chris Campbell in at quarterback. And we have another running back in there. We'll get that for you in just a minute. It is Chris Campbell with a man wide open on the far side, and it is complete to number 84, once again, Sean Renouf.
Guys, Kevin down here on the Wildcats sideline. Of course, the semifinals are set in the PFC. The Thunder will visit the Hilltops, while the Huskies will visit the Calgary Colts. But with these 3-4 teams being so dangerous, do you realize, gentlemen, that if the Thunder and Huskies both win, the Prairie Football Conference final would be held right here at Clark Park Saturday, October 29th. And you never know, Huskies and the Thunder are coming in extremely hot.
Well, the Huskies, no doubt, the hottest team in the PFC, and there's that pickoff, the third of the game for Jaden Dahlke. Dahlke will run it back to the 40-yard line, and boy, I'll tell you what, Johnny on the spot, he picked that one up, stepped right in front of the receiver.
You know, he did a great job reading the young quarterback. Again, he got moved to free safety, and I think Tony Stachuk's on the sideline now. They moved him, get him a rip to free safety, did a good job. Eyes in the backfield, stay focused in a crowd to corral that ball. Did a good job of picking that off, giving the Cats something else to be excited about.
Well, the Cats take over the ball in Thunder territory at the 40. Looking downfield. And it is complete, touchdown! Zachary Burgess, the 18-year-old rookie from LaDuke Composite High School, with his first touchdown in the Prairie Football Conference. That's got to be a huge thrill for the young man.
Oh, you know what? On both ends of that, he had time to throw, great focus. I mean, the DB was in front of him, but that's a great example of Erickson and his ability to throw the ball downfield with accuracy. He led the guy. If he would have thrown a couple of those early, they would have gone for touchdowns. So that was out in front. He didn't have to stop and make a play.
All right, going for the 2 points once again. And this one is going to be incomplete as well. It was knocked down by the Regina defender, number 23, John Martin, out of Balfour High School in Regina.
Well, in a very short amount of time, 18 points on the board for the Wildcats. And I mean, we talked about it, the game is out of reach, kind of. I mean, you never know, it can happen in a hurry. And within the last few minutes, 18 points is coming on quick. And so Regina, you know, the coach over there is gonna expect lots from their young guys. They're gonna have to step up and be ready to play, because you do not want to be putting your veterans back in the game at this point in time, who are cold and cooled off on the sideline.
Well, sure, they've played less than 3 minutes of the fourth quarter, and they've come up with 18 points.
Well, it can be done. I mean, I'm not saying it's going to happen today, but it can be done.
Would that not be something? So the kickoff once again from number 46, Zach Peterson.
Oh,
Zeroni.
Big break for the Cats again. The kickoff returner, because the ball was low, he had to kneel down and get close to the ground, and his knee touched the ground as he caught that, and so they called him down right there on the 8 or 9 yard line. So, you mean, definitely some excitement on this side of the field, and the fans are getting a little bit more exciting into the game, and so we'll see how the last 12 minutes and 19 seconds play out here.
I was going to say, guys, as of this very moment, the hottest team in the PFC are the Edmonton Wildcats.
At least in the last 3 minutes.
It all counts, guys. It all counts.
All right. This is Chris Campbell. Mix up in the backfield. He has to shovel it off. And the ball will go to number 22, Daniel Borgia. And Borgia is going to be hit for a loss of a couple of yards on the play. Make that about 6 yards on the play.
Well, definitely a mix-up. The running back went one way. Quarterback went the other to make the toss. And then ended up with a loss on the play. So Wildcats have some fun football left in them.
11:33 to go in the fourth quarter. 62-18 in favor of the Regina Thunder. Question is, will they take a knee here? Oh, the ball comes out. It's the snap is dropped, but Chris Campbell is able to come up with it. He gets it away up to about the 15-yard line, and making the catch was Greg Lamb. And Lamb will not have enough for the first down. And an injured Regina lineman getting up slowly is number 65, Matt Knight, 6'2", 300-pounder from Michael A. Riffle High School in Regina.
Another gain of 13 yards. It'll be third down, 2 yards to go. Under.
Third and three, and it looks like the punting team will be coming on for the Regina Thunder. So now the defense gets into the act here.
Yeah, they're having fun out there. They're still playing. And again, that's the excitement you hope you have, even in a game that's a blowout at this point. You know, you get the guys out there, you're still plays to be made, and they're going to get the ball back, hopefully, here in field position. I love this formation. Look at this.
They spread them out, and they bring them in. There's the snap. It's a low bouncer. Ruckabar is able to pick it up. He gets a high end-over-end kick. It'll come down short, bounces toward the Thunder, and Ruckabar is in there to pick it up, and the Thunder will, I believe, maintain control of the football. Heads-up play by number 30, Quinton Ruckabar.
Yeah, there is a flag on the play, but I believe that was the punter, and so you know what? Every punter knows if they got a bad kick, get out there, maybe make a play and make up for it.
There you see him coming up from his position and pouncing on the ball.
The Cats definitely have to be aware of that type of situation.
There's no infraction on the play. The player in the restraining zone was the punter. The result of the play is Regina first down.
That's good discipline by the other Regina guys to stay out of the way, but that returner for the Cats, you've got to be aggressive. You've got to go up there and field that ball to get yourself good field position. Unfortunately, a break back in the favor of Regina.
9:57 left. Regina in control at their own 31-yard line. There's the snap, the handoff, and taken down from behind in the backfield. Once again, the ball carrier, Daniel Borgia, but a good job by that Wildcat defensive line to stop that one.
Yeah, Kieran Bell in the backfield making a great play. Again, he's made a number of plays. He's got some great speed at the linebacker position and has the opportunity to beat some offensive line one-on-one and then catch the running back.
Travis Louvre also in there to help out on that tackle. Campbell at quarterback, three flankers on the far side, gets the snap and passes it complete just over the 40-yard line as they wrestle for the football. Tony Savchuk wanted it and wanted it badly, but it looks like they're going to give the tie to the receiver, and that is Jaken Swan.
It'll be close to the first down, and it is a first down.
Take a look at this one, and that was the previous play. All right, Campbell breaks the huddle. Sends Swan out to this side. He's got four back in the backfield. Now everybody heads up. Motion goes to the right. And Campbell swings that way, passes it. And again, intended out there for number 82, Lee Brown. But it's behind him. And with 8:20 to go, it'll be second and 10.
It's a good job on the linebacking core. They picked up the receiver who actually came from the short side slot position, came in behind the offensive line to try to get open. And there you saw the replay of Tony trying to get that ball out. And again, both catching it at the same time does go to the offense, which I enjoyed as a receiver.
There's that snap again. It goes wide, but again, Campbell is able to pull it down. He passes it complete at the 40-yard line. And a great catch going up high for it was Lee Brown. And there's a gain of about 35 yards on that play. And that'll bring the football all the way down to about the to make that the 38-yard line.
You know, there you see another example of timing and belief, and your guy's going to make a play downfield. Great use of hands, great concentration.
And a great job by Campbell to get that one away. He hit just as he let the ball go. Great job in concentration, as you mentioned. Campbell sends everybody out. There's the handoff up the middle. And again, taken by Daniel Borgia. Borgia has some room still going and will be taken down from behind at the 5-yard line as he dragged Michael Baylor all the way down. The youngster from Ross Chef High School in his first year with the Edmonton Wildcats and seeing some action out there. All right, the ball is marked down at the 6 with 6:49 to go. And again, the Regina Thunder knocking on the door. Campbell, quick drop, quick pass in behind the receiver. It'll go incomplete and intended for Greg Lamb, number 21.
Well, a young quarterback, if he keeps his eyes downfield, again, is probably a timing throw. Regina had number one right down the middle of the end zone with no one even close to him. They let him run free right down the middle. So a little defensive mix-up on the side of the Cats, which did not hurt them in that case.
They had scored earlier on that almost exact same play, I think, back in the second quarter. And here's the pass. It's into the end zone. Alley-oop. Complete touchdown. Levi Paul. And again, Paul getting in behind the defender, and that little alley-oop kind of pass that went right over the head of the defender.
Yeah, they just keep making plays. And again, Tony usually playing free safety. He was in a position where he had man-to-man coverage down the goal line. They're obviously intentional on taking that matchup and saying, hey, you got to make a play in the corner of the end zone. And they made the play.
Tony looked like he got turned around a couple of times, too, on that, and was unable to track the football. So the point after from James Reed. This will make it a 69-18 football game with 6:09 to go in the fourth quarter.
Hey, you talk about matchups on the goal line. We talked about earlier. Once you get in there, you know you're going to get man coverage. And often, you know, your free safety isn't necessarily your best man-to-man cover guy. They do a lot of zone in this, so that's not something Tony's necessarily, used to doing a lot of. He just got turned around, as you mentioned, on a nice little corner route. But, again, a very common route that you see down at the end zone. Two receivers underneath running like either a hitch route or a little bang route to hold the defenders, and you run a guy in on the corner route. I mean, at every level they use it. And it can be very successful, as Regina just executed to perfection there.
So 69-18 for the Regina Thunder. Edmonton Wildcats with a brief flurry early in this fourth quarter, scoring 18 points. And the Regina Thunder with a little bit of pushback.
Yeah, you know, that's a great response to a little bit of adversity, right? Something you want to teach your young players, you want to teach your football team, respond to that adversity in a positive way, and that drive showed it right there.
And as we've mentioned, Scott McCauley would like this team to go into the playoffs next weekend with a little bit of momentum on a positive note. There's the kickoff. It'll be taken there by number 22, Isaiah Brown. He has taken every punt and every kick so far in this football game, and he runs that one back about 7 yards. It'll be first down for the Wildcats. They'll mark it just over the 35-yard line at about the 36.
Yeah, again, another decent field position. Not great, but not bad. And so we'll see if the offense can keep some of that momentum they've had on the last couple scores and see if Erickson can deliver some nice footballs to the guys downfield.
This is just invaluable experience for Austin Erickson, the Lacombe grad, getting his first start of the season with the injured Colton Hippie on the sidelines. Sprained ankle, broken tibia. Doesn't get any worse than that.
No, that's a tough injury, and we wish him all the best in the off season. It's going to be a long road to recovery, but knowing him, he's going to work hard at it. He's going to get back as soon as he can.
Guys from the Wildcats sideline had a quick chat with Colton Hippie. He figures it will be at least 3 to 4 months before he can even start physio, guys.
Wow. It's going to be a long, cold winter for young Colton Hippie. There's the handoff to Bray Josu. And Bray is stopped at about the well, after a gain of about maybe a yard or so, but not much more on that. It'll be third and about nine.
One other quick story, Dave. To have that quick chat with Colton Hippie and waiting for him as when he got out of surgery, one of his mom's best friends in less than a day knit him a sock that goes over his cast. So he wanted to throw a shout out to his mom's best friend for knitting this sock, and he needs it out here today. But Colton, definitely an optimistic kid and a tough kid, and he'll be back.
Another great punt by Matt Zeroni, and another pretty good run back, and there is a flag down. It looks like it's going to be a no-yards call against the Wildcats.
Yeah, it's as you said, a great, great punt. Tough no-yards call. It didn't look like, from our point of view, that there was a guy too close to him. But we'll see what they result in. Anyways, the return was nice, too, and saved him a little bit of field position.
Holding is going to be the call. And it'll go against the Regina Thunder.
I think we got one going both ways. We got no yards on one side, holding on the other, which should play into the favor of the Wildcats, considering what that return was.
We'll see where they mark the ball down. They're bringing it back.
We have no yards, number four, on Edmonton. We have holding, Regina. Ball is, penalties applied, 5 yards back, first down.
All right, I think we got that one straightened out, did we?
Well, we're on, I think, the 12-yard line, first down, Regina.
There it is.
That's the important information. There we go, yeah. No yards on the Cats, holding on the Regina Thunder. And here's our result. Back on offense for Regina.
4:15 to go in this fourth quarter. There's the handoff, right side. Gain of maybe three on the play. And carrying the football was, again, Ethan Houts.
Quinton Ruckaber, the ball
carrier. Well, I'm sorry, make that Quinton Ruckaber, number 30.
Brought down by Jerry Hine in the Wildcats. Gain of six, second and four.
So it's a gain of six, second and four. 3:41 to go. Campbell at quarterback. Hands it off once again to Ruckaber, and the big guy just plows his way through a couple of would-be tacklers and is finally stopped at about the 25-yard line. There is a flag on the play.
I think it's probably going to be holding was the initial call, so that's going to move Regina back and put him in second and 14 or so.
Holding, Regina, number 67, half the distance to goal.
He actually got a good view on that replay of the holding call. He had him right by the back of the jersey, was not going to let him chase down the running back.
And speaking of having hands on the back of the jersey, Ruckaber looked like he was being held back, but he just kept on going. He's a big kid with very, very strong legs.
Yes, you're correct. Those are gifted backs, right? They can carry their weight low, they stay low, and they never stop their legs from moving.
And once again, there are three flankers to this side. Two on the other, and the snap is wide, but again, Campbell pulls it down, and there's the pass wide open. Nobody anywhere near number 83, Jaken Swan, and Swan is finally tackled at about the 45-yard line. Clearly a mix-up in coverage, but Jaken Swan had nobody around him for about 5 yards.
Yeah, what happened, they're in what we call a cut coverage, which means the corners take away the flats. The two halfbacks typically get deep thirds, and they ran a deep hook right in front of that deep defender. He stopped his feet thinking that's where he was throwing it. He went right over the top, and that was his responsibility. Unfortunately, he stopped his feet, and that created 40-plus yards of offense.
And their safety, Tony Sapchuk, kind of caught out in no man's land, really.
Well, yeah, he was kind of stuck in the middle of the field, and there's not a chance he's going to get to that outside receiver.
All right, there's a handoff once again to Ruckaber. Quinton Ruckaber carries it over the 40-yard line to about the 37-yard line, and that's where they needed to be to get the first down.
Another holding call, I think, going against Regina is going to move this one back.
You know, nothing to, not to take anything away from the Regina Thunder, this has not been a great half of football for them as compared to the first half. And I wonder if Coach Scott McCauley may be just a little bit concerned about that going into the game against Saskatoon next weekend.
Well, I think he went, you know, even at halftime when they were talking to him, he made the decision his starters were going to sit.
This is true.
And he was committing to that. And so, I mean, let's not put all the blame on the young guys coming in. You mean, it's chemistry, you know. You get two or three guys in who aren't used to being on the O-line or in the backfield. A lot of communication can change, and so they're going to have to polish some of those things up.
There's the pitch out to Ruckavar. He tries to cut it into the middle, but in there to make the stop was Wyatt Schutz, seeing his first action this season, the youngster from Salisbury Comp in Sherwood Park. He makes the tackle.
And just to finish that thought again, as a coach, you know that you're likely going to give up some of the quality for, again, future quality. And that's thinking ahead. That's thinking, okay, let's get the guys the reps now. So when they're starters, they're ready to play. And so that's still a wise decision by your coach.
Hand off, fumbled. Ruckavar is able to jump on it. And when all is said and done, he'll pick up a gain of about a yard or two on the play. But the Regina Thunder will be kicking this one away with 2:25 to go in the fourth quarter.
Yeah, I think we'll have to, after watching that replay, you have to kind of talk both to quarterback and running back on that side. You can see the quarterback didn't really have the ball out to the side, so the angle on that exchange is not very good. And here's my... here we go. Here's a nice, exciting spread punt formation. I'm hoping they actually punt out of this formation. Oh, yet to be disappointed. They got to move back in.
They close it up. And Ruckavar, standing at about his own 41-yard line, will kick this one away. Gets a good end-over-end kick. It'll come down to the 20. It is taken there again by Isaiah Brown on the run. And we have a late flag. It looks like a roughing call. It's going to be an OR, a UR rather. And I think it's going to go against Matt Zeroni. A little extracurricular activity going on.
Yeah, a little bit of emotion going on down there still. I mean, the kids still want to play. The kids still love the game. And they're going to play right to the end here.
And they're going to move the football. They're calling it on Taylor Tangen. And let's see where they're going to mark the ball. Down to the 13-yard line. So the Wildcats have 2 minutes of football left. And try and up the count on the scoreboard a little. They're showing blitz, and there's the handoff to Jordan Samuel. Samuel, in his final game as a Wildcat, will pick up a gain of close to 7, perhaps 8 yards on the play. They'll call it 7, and it'll be 2nd and 3.
Oh, good job of Darcy allowing his veteran to kind of finish off the game here and just, you know, get him his last few touches of wearing a Wildcat uniform.
They break the huddle. Austin Erickson, Samuel in the background, or in the behind him. There it is, another handoff to Samuel. Samuel picks his way through the line and needed to get to about the 23, 24-yard line. And that's where they mark the football, so we'll see whether he got the first down or not. It's going to be close. They call it a first, so the Wildcats will move the football with a minute 33 to go. That's pretty classy of them to hand the ball off to Sam Boyle in his final game as a Wildcat. There's that kind of a Statue of Liberty type thing almost.
A little delayed draw that didn't go so well. I mean, our offensive line typically on a draw need to stay on those bodies a little bit longer just to create a hole up the middle thinking they're going to pass. But they didn't hold the fort down, and the veteran took maybe one of his last hard shots in Wildcats uniform. Two big bodies, strong men in there, really pushing him back and landing on him to finish the tackle off.
Eric Nikiforik for Saskatoon Centennial High School, 6'1", 275. He's a big one. Here's a pass. It is into the middle. It is complete at the 45-yard line, and a huge gain for the Edmonton Wildcats, and a nice catch by Luther Hakunavenu. and I promise to practice all winter long on that name.
Hey, you're doing a great job. I remember game one of the year.
It's rolling off your tongue now.
Oh, smooth talking devil that you are. All right, there's the handoff. Samuel takes it to the outside, now cuts in and carries it up almost to the 50-yard line, to about the 49, and that'll be a gain of close to 5 yards.
Wanted to say, guys, down here on the Wildcat sideline, what a tribute to head coach Darcy Park and his coaching staff. I mean, it's a crutch convention down here on the sideline. This Wildcat team does not know the word quit.
Erickson out of the pocket. He is taken down and sacked by number 78. Turnbull.
Looks like Darcy's opted to leave his offense out there, let him get another shot here, continuing this drive with the last few seconds left on the clock.
Traxton Turnbull, number 78, with the tackle. And the loss is about 4 yards. It'll be third and 14. They're going for it, of course. Looking downfield, this is the high floater. It is up for grabs. It is picked off by the Wildcats. And sneaking in there to grab that one after it bounced off a couple of pairs of hands was number 82, Dalton Latosky.
Well, if there are some positives to take, you know, you finish on a nice play made by a receiver downfield. And again, those are the types of plays that the Cats just need to create more of, where there's more bodies there, more guys ready to make plays and, you know, to send off your graduating players here. You know, a little bit to be excited about in the last quarter.
Great way to end the football game and a good way to end the season for this Edmonton Wildcats squad. They will spend the winter examining what has happened, do a lot of recruiting, and hope for better things in 2017.
Yeah, so much of the work for players in any organization happens in your off season. Obviously, you want to be part of the postseason, which the Cats won't be this year. But for the players, you know, Darcy needs to talk to the kids, and I know he will. He'll deliver the message that, you know what, if each and every player returning next year to the Cats gets better, you know, the whole team is going to elevate to another level, and that's what they need to do. The players are going to have to take on the responsibility of, you know, training their bodies, training their minds, with regards to football, but this is the opportunity they're going to have. You know, a young team with a lot of guys coming back next year, it's their opportunity to kind of, you know, make a statement next year coming out after lots of work in the offseason.
Well, being the head coach of Millwoods Christian, you've been through this before, the offseason, the season ends. Take us through, if you like, on a month-to-month basis as to what a coach will be doing heading into the next season.
Well, I just worry about catching up on my classes first as soon as we're done. Once I'm caught
aside from going down to Palm Springs, I mean.
Yeah, once I'm caught up on my classes, and my principal knows that happens sometimes, you know, you want to give your players a little bit of a break, not only physically but mentally, a little bit of a break from football. And again, a lot of the players in a situation like this, they're going to be keen. So, you know, you develop a program that allows them to still do some training over the next month, but not heavy training. And then really you go into the different phases of training your body. And just so when you come into the next season, you're coming in at a higher level from a strength and a speed and a stamina standpoint. Because over the course of a season that these guys play, there's always attrition. There's always the weakening of your body because you just can't train as much because your focus turns to football. So now is the time where the focus turns and flips to, okay, now you need to train your body. You know, you give it about 4 or 5 months, probably February, March, then you start introducing the football piece back into the kids. So it allows them to train their bodies to become bigger, stronger, and faster. And then you, okay, now we're going to step and watch, do the football piece. They do need a break. And, I see so much in young athletes. They spend all year playing certain sports. Football's a little bit harder in this country because you can't be outside. But you see soccer players and hockey players playing year-round. You need a mental break from the game, which will allow you to, you know, be better when you're back in the season. And so I think it's important with football players. It's physically demanding. Give them the physical rest, but also the mental rest, and allow them to get excited again in about 3 or 4 months, saying, okay, hey, we're ready for the next season.
All right, hey, let's go downstairs. Here's Kevin Donnan with a couple of special guests. Kevin?
Thanks a lot, Dave. I am here with Taylor Mayer, who had 3 interceptions today. First of all, congratulations. Thunder heading up the road to Saskatoon.
Yeah, We're excited about the win, and, you know, we're on a two-game win streak now, so, you know, we're feeling really good to tune for playoffs next week.
Now, are you got to feel really good knowing just how well you've knocked out your numbers. You can't business.
We're coming, like, coming off a huge high, knocking off Calgary, giving them their first loss of the season. So, you know, we were amped up coming into this game, too, to play Edmonton. So, yeah, you know, we're really happy and really excited to play next week against Saskatoon.
Battle of Saskatchewan, no one get up for that one.
No, you know, it's always a game with Saskatoon with the Sask rivalry. So, you know, it's always an intense game.
Sounds good. Congratulations on the win today. Scott McCauley. We could bring the head coach. Come on in. You've got to be very excited about the performance of your club in this one.
Yeah, especially a lot of our young guys. You know, we didn't travel Sawyer, and we gave the rock to Sitch to start off the game and stuff. He did a great job, and I just think that we have a lot of depth going into the playoffs here. Looking forward to seeing how things go.
Now, you traveled road to Saskatoon. It can be done. You knocked off the Colts last week. Take us through your preparation.
I think, like, for us right now, we've already played Saskatoon twice. We have a good idea what our game plans are going to be. So it's just going to be a week making sure we just wrap it up so come game time, it's second nature to everybody.
And you're coming out of this game relatively injury free. Maybe some bumps and bruises, but you've got to be feeling good. You're peaking at the right time.
Yeah, we're feeling very confident right now, and we'll see how things go when we get into the playoffs.
And you might be back here in 2 weeks. The two most dangerous teams in the PFC are your team and the Huskies. You might be back here.
Well, I would love to come back to Edmonton. So hopefully we'll see everybody here soon.
Okay, sounds great. That is head coach Scott McCauley of the Regina Thunder, who's pretty excited about next week, and who isn't excited about next week if you're a fan of the PFC. Dave, Rob?
Heading down the road to Calgary next weekend, and I don't know, you going to join me for that one, Kevin?
Well, you know, why not? I mean, it'd be a great trip, and I'll tell you, that Huskies team is ready to go after last night.
Well, it should be an interesting weekend, and boy, I'll tell you what, it would be just wonderful if we could have a championship PFC final game right here at Clark Park.
Would love to see it.
It could happen. And, you know, at this time, we usually take a look at the statistics. And really, when you get right down to it, with the final score being 69-18, statistics are just numbers at that point.
Yeah, the score in this case will reflect the statistics. I think, you know, more importantly, I think the excitement around football out in the prairies right now for the Prairie Football Conference is good. And, you know, we've talked about four quality teams going in, and that just speaks to the quality of football out in the prairies. You know, we've got a lot of young men playing football. You know, we're trying to always do things better out in the world of football. And so, you know, to see those guys develop and to have four quality teams really that anyone could win next week is going to be exciting to watch those games.
Well, just suffice to say, 803 yards total offense for the Regina Thunder. And I guess that kind of says it all, folks. There's nothing much more that we can add from a numerical point of view. I just want to do at this point, thank you for a great season and helping out with the color commentary. Just phenomenal time. We've had a lot of fun.
You know what? It has been fun. And I've enjoyed spending the time talking football, watching football, and watching the team develop. I know, you know, from a wins-loss standpoint, the Cats aren't so excited about the year. But again, we've seen some growth. We've seen young players learn about football, which again, hopefully we'll see an improvement next year.
And I want to thank Kevin Donnan. Kevin has been through, he's like a postman down there. He's been through.
You know, I'm the son of a letter. Ironically, I am the son of a letter carrier who has been, and I guess I can now say I've been through snow and sleet and rain and all sorts of things. Well, I've learned a lot about football this year, and a great deal about meteorology as well.
There you go. And, of course, the technical staff up here from Rod Zitlow right on down through our camera operators and our technicians up here in the broadcast booth. They've done just a tremendous job all season. The folks from ICU Video, thank you very much. And the last word, as always, goes to Kevin Donovan.
Thanks so much, Dave, and thanks to both of you. And that brings the final week of the 2016 Prairie Football Conference regular season to a close. ICU Video Productions would like to thank you, our loyal viewers across the internet and on Shaw Television, for allowing us to bring the exciting action of the Prairie Football Conference and the Huskies and Wildcats. And with ICU Video, we don't webcast, we procast. And we want to wish all of the teams in the Prairie Football Conference good luck in the playoffs. Of course, next week, the Huskies visit the Colts and the Hilltops take on the Thunder. And of course, as Dave mentioned, our entire crew, we want to thank today and throughout the season for their hard work, professionalism, and excellence. On behalf of the Edmonton Wildcats Football Club and ICU Video, we want to thank executive producer Rob Zitla, Dave Foley, our technical advisor, Mark St. Arnaud, Terry Farina, and Matt Mosiewicz on camera, switcher Kyle Matz, director Connor O'Donovan, and of course, our broadcast team of Dave Rozak and Rob Harrod. Your final score, the Regina Thunder 69, the Edmonton Wildcats 18. My name is Kevin Dawn, and thanks for joining us throughout the 2016 PFC season. We'll see you in 2017, and have a pleasant evening from Clark Park in Edmonton.